Chapter 20. The Carradine ambassador arrived with his entourage on the recently repaired West Landing platform, far from the Imperial Palace. His diplomatic shuttle looked like a glossy black beetle, bristling with weapons that had been remotely neutralized before the ship was allowed to approach Coruscant. On the landing platform, Leia waited to greet Ambassador Fergan with a full contingent of New Republic Honor Guard. The wind picked up, blowing around the tall buildings, as if trying to push the Carradine delegation back in the direction it had come. She wore her formal government robes as well as rank insignia for the Alliance forces. Carida, with its powerful military training center, was one of the most important strongholds still loyal to the Empire. If she could crack open negotiations with them, her coup would not be soon forgotten. But the Carradine system was going to be a tough jewel fruit to crack, especially with a rude and icy ambassador like Fergan. The shuttle's hatch hissed open as the denser air of Carida rushed out. Two stormtroopers marched down the ramp, shouldering ceremonial blaster rifles equipped with bayonets. Their white armor gleamed from meticulous polishing. They moved like droids, walking off the ramp and stepping to either side, then freezing in position as a second pair of stormtroopers followed them down and waited at the end of the ramp. Ambassador Fergan strode down, stubby-legged and self-important, as if to ceremonial music. His uniform was spattered with more badges, insignia, and ribbons than any person could possibly have earned in a lifetime. After two more stormtrooper officers followed the ambassador down, Fergan drew a deep breath, looking into the distance and ignoring Leia. Ah, the air of Imperial Center. He turned toward the waiting reception committee, beetling his thick brows. Smells a bit sour now, though. The taint of rebellion. Leia disregarded the comment. Welcome to Coruscant, Ambassador Fergan. I am Minister of State Leia Organa Solo. Yes, yes, Fergan said impatiently. After Mon Mothma's words about the extreme importance of Carida, I expected her to send more than a minor official to greet me. A slap in the face. Leia had to fall back on some of Luke's temper-controlling exercises, a Jedi mind-blanking technique that allowed her to quell the surge of anger. I see you have not taken the time to familiarize yourself with the structure of our government, Ambassador. Though Mon Mothma is the New Republic's chief of state, the cabinet is the actual governing body, of which the Minister of State and my subordinate diplomatic corps comprise perhaps the most important arm. Leia stopped herself, angry with Fergan for goading her, and angry with herself for letting him manipulate her into petty games. Mon Mothma had instructed her to extend every diplomatic courtesy to the ambassador. She wished Han or Luke were there beside her. Mon Mothma has a great many other duties, but she has arranged for a brief face-to-face meeting with you later in the day, Leia said. Until then, would you like me to show you to your quarters? Some refreshment, perhaps, after your journey? Fergan's eyes looked like small, overripe berries as he directed his gaze at her. My bodyguards will go to my quarters first. They will sweep every inch of the rooms, every appliance, every wall and floor to remove hidden listening devices or assassination tools. The remaining guards will be with me at every moment. They will provide my food and drink from our own supplies to ensure against any possibility of poisoning. Leia was appalled at his insinuation. She stopped herself from insisting that Fergan's actions were not necessary, since that would no doubt play directly into his hands. Instead, she showed him a small indulgent smile. Of course, if such things make you feel more comfortable. In the meantime, Fergan said, I would like an immediate tour of the Imperial Palace. Arrange one. I came on a pilgrimage to see my Emperor's home and to pay my respects. Leia hesitated. We hadn't planned on. Fergan held up a hand. Beside him the stormtroopers snapped even more stiffly to attention. The ambassador took one step closer to Leia, as if trying to look intimidating. Nevertheless, you will arrange it. That afternoon, Mon Mothma stood in the dimmed audience chamber, waiting at the base of the holoprojector's controls. Though she had a thousand other duties to attend to, Carida seemed the likeliest flashpoint of resistance to New Republic stability. She had made it clear to Leia that she considered her sacrifice of time an investment to avert a possible war. Without moving, Mon Mothma seemed to fill the room with her quiet, commanding presence. Leia never ceased admiring her subtle but undeniable power, which Mon Mothma managed to exhibit even without Jedi training. Leia followed Ambassador Fergan as he strode down the ramp to the base of the holoprojector. Grumpy, he looked behind him to where his stormtrooper bodyguards waited at the entrance to the chamber. Fergan had refused to leave them behind, and Mon Mothma had refused to let even disarmed Imperial stormtroopers near her. The power play had been brief and sharp, but in the end Mon Mothma allowed the stormtroopers to wait within sight of the ambassador, though outside the chamber. But she had also won a seemingly minor concession. Mon Mothma required the stormtroopers to remove their helmets while they remained in her presence. The soldiers stood unmasked, holding the skull-like helmets under their arms, revealed to be humans, young cadets dressed in armor but with their anonymity taken away. "Stand right there, Ambassador Fergan," she said without formally greeting him. "I would like to show you something." The holoprojector shimmered, and the known galaxy filled the room, billions of star specks flung in swirling arms throughout the enclosed chamber. The lights automatically dimmed as the sea spray of stars came into focus. At the doorway, the stormtroopers craned their necks to stare up at the huge image. On the chamber floor, both Mon Mothma and Ambassador Fergan seemed insignificant. "This is our galaxy," Mon Mothma said. "We have meticulously plotted every recorded system. These stars," she waved her hand, and a wash of blue spangled across the arms of the galaxy, "have already sworn their allegiance to the New Republic. Others have remained neutral, though not unfriendly to our cause." A sprinkling of green appeared among the stars. "The darkened area is what remains of the Shiruk Imperium." She indicated a splotch covering a portion of one spiral arm. "We have not yet fully explored their worlds, though it has been 7 years since Imperial and Alliance forces joined hands at Bakura to drive out the invaders." "Finally," Mon Mothma said, "we know of these systems that still remain loyal to the Fallen Empire." A much smaller splash of red dusted the image, concentrated primarily toward the galactic core, from which the resurrected Emperor had launched his forces. "As you can see, your support is dwindling rapidly." Fergan did not seem impressed. "Anyone can paint dots on a map." Inwardly outraged, Leia marveled at the quiet way Mon Mothma handled the situation. Her voice did not grow louder, she merely looked at him with her calm, deep eyes. "You are welcome to speak to any of the ambassadors from these worlds to confirm their allegiances. Ambassadors can be bribed as easily as colors can be changed on a projection map." This time Mon Mothma's voice grew just a bit brittle. "There are no bribes that can change the facts, Ambassador Fergan." "If that is the case, then sometimes the facts themselves must be changed." Leia could not keep herself from rolling her eyes. In a way this was amusing, but it seemed like a waste of time. Fergan was as unchangeable as a man frozen in carbonite. The entire planetary surface of Coruscant had been covered with layer upon layer of buildings, rebuilt, demolished, and rebuilt again. Galactic governments changed over the millennia, but Coruscant had always been the center of politics. The complex construction patterns and towering metal and transparent steel pinnacles made weather difficult to predict. Occasionally, unexpected storms coalesced out of water evaporating from millions of exhaust vents, condensing and rising from the skyscraper forests, making small squalls that dumped rain down upon the hard surfaces of the buildings. As the various diplomats gathered in the Skydome Botanical Gardens for Ambassador Fergan's reception, a sudden flurry of raindrops pattered down on the transparent panes, masking the bright curtains of Coruscant's aurora. In the distance, near the horizon, the rebuilt Imperial Palace stood like a cobbled-together cathedral and pyramid, showing signs of many different eras. Leia had not wanted Fergan's reception to be held in any place that recalled the fallen Emperor's opulence and grandeur. The Skydome Botanical Gardens rested on the level roof of an isolated skyscraper. constructed by an old Republic philanthropist who had grown rich by establishing the Galactic News Service, the giant terrarium was a carefully tended place with compartmentalized environments to house and display otherwise extinct or exotic flora from various systems in the galaxy. Leia arrived with 3PO and her two children in tow just as the rain began to fall against the transparent ceiling. As Leia stepped through the door, she held herself defensively, her justifications on the tip of her tongue. She knew the presence of the twins might cause a stir at a stuffy diplomatic reception, but she did not care. Throughout the day, Fergan had pushed her around, complaining, demanding, acting generally rude. Leia had given up all of her time with the twins to be with the ambassador, and she decided that it was no longer worth the misery. She might be an important cabinet member in the new republic, but she was also a mother, still trying to adapt to the new demands on her time. In her quarters while changing clothes for the reception, Leia had felt her simmering resentment come to a boil. If she was going to be gone all the time anyway, she might as well have left Jason and Jaina with Winter. Besides, 3PO accompanied them, and he was a protocol droid. He could watch the twins and also help out with the fine points of the reception and translation if need be. Since Han had disappeared, she was worried to the point of nausea much of the time. Luke and Lando had sent no word yet. She needed to have some stable point in her life. Leia almost hoped someone would challenge her about bringing the twins, so she could lash out. When she passed through the door, Fergan's stormtrooper goons stopped her. The still helmetless stormtroopers looked uncomfortable at meeting her eye to eye, but they stood firmly in her path. Behind them, an equal number of New Republic guards stood at attention, watching the stormtroopers. "What is the problem?" She glanced at the stormtrooper's insignia and deliberately misread it, "Lieutenant."
"Captain," he corrected.
"We're checking everyone. A precaution against assassins." "Assassins?" she said, deciding to be amused rather than upset.
"I see."
One of the stormtroopers removed a handheld scanner and played it over Leia's body, testing for hidden weapons. Leia icily submitted to the scan. "This is for the ambassador's safety," he said. He looked disapprovingly at Jason and Jaina. "We weren't informed there would be children attending. Are you afraid one of them is going to murder Ambassador Fergan?" Leia stared at the man's naked, pale face, scowling until he flinched. "That doesn't say much for your skills as a bodyguard, does it, Captain?" His flustered fidgeting was worth any amount of inconvenience he might cause her, Leia thought. "Just routine precautions." The captain scanned Jason and Jaina, showing visible discomfort at having to do so. When his task was complete, he still refused to move aside. Leia crossed her arms over her chest. "Now what?"
"Your droid, Minister," the captain said.
"We need to run a complete systems check. He could have assassin droid programming."
"Me, sir?"
3PO said.
"Oh, my.
You can't be serious." Leia rolled her eyes at the mere thought of the prissy protocol droid being an assassin. "And how long will this complete systems check take?"
"Not long."
The captain took a different scanner that trailed disconnected leads. "Mistress Leia, I object." 3PO's voice carried an edge of panic. "If you will recall, I have been maliciously reprogrammed in the past. I never want to trust a strange probe again." Leia spoke to the droid but let her gaze bore into the stormtrooper captain's eyes. "Let him do it, 3PO. And if your programming is altered in the slightest, this man will be responsible for a galactic incident that could well lead to war, a war in which his own home system of Kurita would be the prime target for the combined forces of the New Republic."
"I will be very careful, Minister," the stormtrooper said.
"Indeed, sir, you will," 3PO insisted. When they finally managed to get through to the reception area, the rainfall dwindled to a trickle. People wandered along the tour paths to observe the brilliant and bizarre shapes of alien plant life. As the guests stepped through force field environmental barriers, the humidity and temperature changed drastically to provide proper growing conditions for various types of plants.
Tiny placards displayed scientific names written in a dozen different alphabets. Holding their mother's hands, Jason and Jaina stared with amazement at the people garbed in diplomatic finery, the exotic plants from distant worlds. In a bright desert scenario at the center of the chamber, monstrously large tentacle cactus served hors d'oeuvres, waving its thick stalks back and forth and displaying tiny sandwiches, fruit slices, sausages, and pastries stuck on its long spines. Guests snatched snacks from the spines whenever the tentacle cactus waved in their direction. Stocky Ambassador Fergan seemed the center of attention, but everyone looked at him from the corners of their eyes rather than speaking to him directly. Feeling her political obligations, Leia sighed and walked toward him, the children trotting beside her. Fergan fixed his gaze on the twins and drained the drink he was holding. She watched as he held the empty glass to a pump flask at his right hip. Fergan depressed the button and squirted himself a new drink of honey greenish liquid. Of course, she thought, anyone paranoid about poisons would bring his own supply. He wore an identical flask on his left hip. So, Minister Organa Solo, these are the famous Jedi twins. Jason and Jaina, I believe you named them. Don't you have a third child as well, named Anakin? Leia blinked, unnerved that Fergan knew so much about her family. Yes, the baby is elsewhere, safe and protected. She knew he could not possibly have uncovered the location of the sheltered planet, but a mother's instinct magnified her fear. Fergan patted Jaina on the head. I hope you protect these two as well. It would be a shame for such sweet children to become political pawns. They are very safe, Leia said, suddenly feeling helpless. Keeping an eye on the ambassador, she turned the twins around. You two take 3PO and go play now. It will be a very educational experience for them, Mistress Leia, 3PO said, bustling the children off to look at the plant exhibits. Fergan continued his conversation with Leia. If you want my opinion, it's too bad the Emperor didn't manage to wipe out all of the Jedi. Incomplete tasks always end up causing trouble. And why are you so afraid of the Jedi Knights? Leia said. Though she disliked this line of conversation, she might glean some information from Fergan. The ambassador took a long sip from his drink. My feeling is that with our sophisticated technology, we should not cringe in fear of sorcery and bizarre mental powers that belong only to a few random individuals. It seems elitist. Jedi Knights. They were like strongmen for a weak old government. Leia took up the debate. The Emperor whom you revere so much was very powerful in the Force, as was Darth Vader. How are they so different? The Emperor is entitled to special powers, Fergan said, as if stating the obvious. After all, he's the Emperor. And Vader turned out to be a traitor in the end. As I understand it, he was the one who actually killed the Emperor. All the more reason to outlaw such powers. Leia knew he must have seen Luke's widely broadcast speech to the Council. Nevertheless, the Jedi have managed to survive, and the entire Order of Jedi Knights will be restored. My brother will see to that. Within a few years the new Jedi Knights will fill the same role as the old, as protectors of the Republic. Too bad, Fergan said, turning away to seek other conversation, but no one seemed to want to talk to him. 3PO lost track of the twins almost immediately, when they decided to play hide-and-seek among the flora exhibits, crawling under guardrails too low for 3PO to manage, then chasing each other around areas marked, "Do not enter." When the droid called for them to come back, Jason and Jaina developed a selective hearing difficulty and continued to dash away. He chased them through a grove of mucus trees that dripped yellow-pollinated ooze all over his polished body shell, but at least the slime left a trail of footprints for him to follow. 3PO wailed in dismay when he saw the small footprints leading directly into the carnivorous plants area. Oh, my, he said, imagining bloodthirsty shrubs already digesting pieces of the small children. Before he could sound an all-out alarm, though, 3PO heard Jason's high-pitched giggles, joined by his sister's laughter. Using directional locators, 3PO bustled back to the center of the exhibit. Sitting in the middle of the giant tentacle cactus, the twins played with the waving fronds, oblivious to the thorns. Somehow they had blithely eased their way past the dagger-like points and made a pillow out of the central mass of fine new bristles. "Master Jason and Mistress Jaina, come out of there this instant," 3PO said in a stern voice. "I must insist." Instead, Jaina giggled and waved to him. In a tizzy, 3PO wondered how he could rescue the children from the great plant, without dislodging any of the hors d'oeuvres. A lull fell in the conversation, the type of pause that often occurs in forced social situations. During the quiet, Ambassador Fergan made his move. "I require your attention," he called. Leia watched him suddenly step away from her. Not knowing what he might do, she tensed, ready for anything. The few conversations stuttered to a halt. All eyes turned to the Carradine ambassador. Mon Mothma had been chatting with General Jan Dadonna, the aged tactician who had planned the strike on the first Death Star. Mon Mothma raised her eyebrows, curious at Fergan's call for silence. Jan Dadonna stopped telling his tale and held his hands in mid-gesture as he stared. Fergan took his empty glass and dropped it to his hip, filling it from the left hip flask this time. Leia wondered if he had already emptied the right flask. Raising his glass high, he took one step toward Mon Mothma, grinning. Leia watched in disbelief. Was the rude ambassador going to propose a toast? Fergan looked around the enclosed skydome, making certain he had everyone's attention. Even the patchy rain had ceased. "To all gathered here, I wish to be heard. As ambassador of Karita, I have been empowered to speak for the Imperial Military Training Center, my planet, and my entire system. Therefore, I must deliver a message to you all." He raised his voice and raised his glass. "To Mon Mothma, who calls herself leader of the New Republic." With a vicious sneer, he hurled his drink into her face. The honey-green liquid splashed on her cheeks, her hair, her chest. She staggered back, appalled. Jan Dadonna caught her shoulders, steadying her, his mouth gaped open in astonishment. The New Republic guards at the door immediately drew their weapons but somehow refrained from firing. "We denounce your foul rebellion of lawbreakers and murderers. You have tried to impress me with the number of other weak-minded systems that have joined your alliance, but no amount of rabble can erase your crimes against the Empire." He smashed his empty glass on the floor and ground the shards under his boot heel. "Karita will never surrender to your so-called New Republic." With a flourish, Fergan took his entourage and stormed off. At the doorway, the gathered stormtroopers triumphantly placed the white helmets back on their heads, hiding their faces, and followed the ambassador out. The New Republic guard stared after them, weapons ready but not knowing what to do. After a shocked silence, the crowd erupted into a babble of outraged conversations. Leia ran to the chief of state. Dadonna was already swabbing at Mon Mothma's damp robes. The sticky drink drying on her face, Mon Mothma forced a smile for Leia. Into the rising hubbub of indignation she said, "Well, we didn't lose anything by trying, did we?" In her disappointment, Leia could not answer. The tinny voice of 3PO burst over the background noise. "Excuse me, Mistress Leia?" Leia frantically looked around for the twins, afraid Fergan had somehow kidnapped them during his diversion, but was relieved when she saw Jason and Jaina standing with their faces pressed against the curved window looking out at the skyline of Imperial City. Finally, from the corner of her eye, she noticed a golden arm flailing about in alarm. Somehow 3PO had gotten tangled in the tentacle cactus exhibit, even from across the room Leia could see how badly scratched his plating had become. Hors d'oeuvres lay scattered about the floor. "Could anyone assist me in getting free from this plant?" 3PO cried. "Please." Chapter 21. Han Solo seemed to be drowning in a syrup of nightmares. He could not escape the drugged and painful interrogation, as the hardened and porcelain beautiful face of Admiral Dalla stared at him, and pummeled him with questions. "Just put him over here, a woman's trilling voice said. Not Dala. His body was being dragged like luggage across a floor. We have been ordered to stand guard, said a fuzzed voice filtered through a stormtrooper helmet. Stand guard, then, but do it outside my lab. I want to talk to him in peace. The woman's voice again. For your own protection, the stormtrooper began. Han felt himself drop to the floor. His limbs didn't seem to remember how to bend. Protection? What is he going to do? He doesn't seem to have the energy to sneeze. If you left any unscrambled memories in his head, I want to pick at them without any interference. Han felt himself hauled upright again, his arms wrapped behind him. Cold, smooth stone pressed against his back. Yes, yes, the woman's voice said, chain him to the column. I'm sure I'll be safe. I promise to stay out of reach of his fangs. He heard the marching boots of stormtroopers leaving the room. His mind became active long before his body figured out how to respond. He remembered parts of the interrogation, but not all of it. What had he told Admiral Dala? His heart began pounding harder. Had he divulged any crucial secrets? Did he even know any crucial secrets? He was fairly certain he had told her the basic events about the fall of the Empire and the rise of the New Republic, but that caused no harm, and it might even lead to benefits. If Dala knew she had no chance, perhaps she would surrender. And if Banthas had wings? His eyes finally opened grudgingly, letting light slam inside. He flinched away from returning vision, but eventually his eyes focused. He found himself in a spacious room, some kind of laboratory or analysis center, not his detention cell on the Gorgon. He heard singing and the sound of flutes. Han turned his head to see a willowy alien woman standing in front of a device that seemed to be a combination musical keyboard and data entry pad. He had heard her voice arguing with the stormtrooper. She hummed a complex string of notes as her fingers played on the musical keys. In front of her, a rotating blueprint of a three-dimensional triangular shape took form, like a shard of glass capped with a tetrahedron and some sort of energy pod dangling from the lower point. With each tone the woman processed, additional lines appeared on the complicated diagram. Han worked his tongue around in his mouth and tried to talk. He meant to say, "Who are you?" but his lips and vocal cords would not cooperate. The sounds came out more like, "Wah. You're." Startled, the female alien fluttered her slender hands around the 3D geometrical image. Then she pranced over to where Han lay. She wore a badge on her smock, imprinted with her likeness and glittering holograms of the kind used for cipher locks. She was an attractive humanoid, tall and slender, with a bluish tint to her skin. Her gossamer hair seemed like strands of pearlescent feathers. When she spoke, her voice was high and reedy. Her eyes were wide and deep blue, carrying an expression of perpetual astonishment. "I've been waiting for you to wake up," she said. "I have so many questions to ask you. Is it true that you actually set foot on the first Death Star, and you got a look at the second one while it was under construction? Tell me what it was like. Anything you can remember. Every detail would be like a treasure trove to me." The babbled questions came at him too quickly to assimilate. What did the Death Star have to do with anything? That was 10 years ago. Instead, Han focused his gaze past her. Pastel gases glowed on the other side of the broad window, swirling around the insatiable mouths of the black holes. He counted all 4 Star Destroyers in orbital formation high above. That meant he must be somewhere in the little cluster of planetoids in the center of the gravitational island. And he was alone. Neither Kip nor Chewbacca had ended up here with him. He hoped they had at least survived Dala's vicious interrogation. He worked his mouth, trying to form words again. "Who are you?" The alien woman touched her badge with one of her long-fingered hands. "My name is Kui Zux. And I know that you are Han Solo. I've read a hard copy of the debriefing you gave Admiral Dala." Debriefing? Did she mean the interrogation, the torture chair that made his entire body spasm? Kwee-Zuxa's entire demeanor seemed superficial and distracted, as if she were paying only a small amount of attention to details while she kept her mind preoccupied with something else. "Now then, please tell me about the Death Star. I'm very eager to hear what you remember. You're the first person I can talk to who was actually there." Han wondered if the interrogation drugs were still muddling his brain, or if there really was a reason why someone should want him to talk about the defunct Death Star. And why should he tell this Imperial scientist anything anyway? Had he divulged anything important to Dala? What if she took her 4 Star Destroyers and attacked Coruscant? "I've already been interrogated." He was pleased to hear his words come out clearly enough to be understood this time. In one bluish hand Kui held up a short printout. "I want your real impressions about it," she continued. "What did it sound like? What did it feel like when you walked down the corridors? Tell me everything you can remember." She wrung her hands in barely restrained excitement. "No." His response apparently shocked Kui enough that she took a step backward and let out a startled musical squawk. "You have to. I'm one of the top scientists here." Her mouth hung partly open in confusion. She began to pace around the pillar where he had been bound, forcing Han to turn his head. The effort nearly made him pass out. "What good does it do to withhold information?" Kui asked. "Information is for everyone. We build on the knowledge we have, add to it, and leave a greater legacy for our successors." Kui struck him as being impossibly naive. Han wondered how long she had been sheltered in the middle of the black hole cluster. "Does that mean you share your information with anyone who asks?" he said. Kui bobbed her head. "That's the way Maw installation works. It is the foundation of all our research." Han barely managed a grin of triumph. "All right, then tell me where my friends are." "I came in here with a young man and a Wookiee. Share that information with me, and I'll see what I can remember about the Death Star." Kui's uneasy reaction told him that she had never before considered anything but clear-cut cases. "I don't know if I can tell you that," she said. "You don't have a need to know." Han managed a shrug. "Then I see how much your own code of ethics means to you." Kui glanced toward the door, as if contemplating whether to summon the stormtroopers after all. "It is in my charter here as a researcher that I have access to all the data I need. Why won't you answer my few simple questions? Why won't you answer mine?" "I never signed your charter. I'm under no obligation to you." Han waited, fixing his eyes on her as she fidgeted. Finally, Kui pulled out her data pad and hummed as she keyed in a request. She looked at him with wide, deep blue eyes that blinked rapidly. Her hair seemed like a glittering waterfall of fine down spilling to her shoulders. When she whistled again, the data pad gave a response. "Your Wookiee companion has been assigned to a labor detail in the engine maintenance sector. The physicist formerly in charge of concept development and implementation always swore by Wookiee laborers. He had about 100 of them taken from Kashyyyk and brought to the installation when it was formed. We don't have many left. It's hard and dangerous work there, you know." Han shifted his position, still finding it difficult to move. He had heard rumors that Wookiee slaves had been put to work during the actual construction of the first Death Star. But Kui spoke of these things with simple frankness. "What about my other friend?" Han asked. "Someone named Kip Duran, is that him?" "He is still aboard the Gorgon in the detention area, high security. I don't see much of a report from his debriefing, so apparently he didn't have much to tell them." Han frowned, trying to assess the information, but Kui became animated again. "All right, I've shared the information you wanted. Now tell me about the Death Star." She stepped closer to him but remained well out of reach. Han rolled his eyes but saw no reason not to. The Death Star had been destroyed long ago, and the plans were safely locked inside the protected data core of the former Imperial Information Center. Han told Kui about the corridors, the noises. He knew the most about the hangar bay, the detention area, and the garbage masher, but she didn't seem much interested in those details. But did you see the core? The propulsion systems? Sorry. I was just running interference while someone else knocked out the tractor beam generators. Han pursed his lips. Why are you so interested in all this anyway? She blinked her eyes. Because I designed most of the Death Star. Before she could notice Han's shocked response, she trotted over to the near wall and worked a few controls that turned a section of the metal plating transparent. Suddenly a dizzying panorama replaced his narrow view of the bright gases. He could see the other clustered rocks that made up Maw's installation. In fact, we've still got the prototype Death Star right here at the installation. As Kui spoke, a gigantic wireframe sphere as large as any of the asteroids rose behind the shortened horizon of the nearest planetoid like a deadly sunrise. The prototype looked like a giant armillary sphere, circular rings connected at the poles and spread out for support. Nested in the framework and superstructure hung the enormous reactor core and the planet-destroying superlaser. This is just the functional part, Kui said, staring out the window with admiration in her eyes. The core, the superlaser, and the reactor, without a hyperdrive propulsion system. We didn't see any need to add the structural support and all the housing decks for troops and administrators. Han found his voice again. Does it work? Kui smiled at him, her eyes sparkling. Oh yes, it works beautifully. Kip Duran felt like an animal trapped in a cage. He stared at the dull confining walls of the detention cell. Illumination came through slitted grills in the ceiling, too bright and too reddish to be comfortable on his eyes. He sat on his bunk, stared at the wall, and tried not to think. Leftover pain still throbbed through his body. The interrogator droid had been vicious in finding the pain stimuli in his body, damping endorphins so the slightest scratch seemed like agony. The sharp hypodermic needles felt like spears as they plunged into his flesh, the will-breaking drugs flowed like lava through his veins. He had begged his memories to divulge some detail the interrogators would find useful, if only to stop the questioning, but Kip Duran was nobody, a hapless prisoner who had spent most of his life on Kessel. He didn't know anything to tell the Imperial monsters. In the end they had found him worthless. Kip stared at the self-making meal the door dispenser had given to him. By opening the lid of the pack, he spontaneously heated the textured protein main course and chilled the synthetic fruit dessert. After a short time the utensils themselves began to break down and could be eaten as snacks. But Kip could find no spark of hunger inside him. His thoughts drifted again to Han Solo's predicament. Unlike Kip, Han knew a great deal about the New Republic and had many secrets to divulge. Han's interrogation would have been far more thorough than his own. And Admiral Dalla's ministrations had been worse than anything Kip had experienced during his years in the Imperial Correction Facility. At least down in the spice mines he knew how to avoid calling attention to himself. Since the age of 8, Kip had lived on Kessel, coping with the rules, the torturous work, the miserable conditions under the old imperial rule or under the chain of usurpers and slave lords such as Morath Duel. His parents were dead, his brother Zeth conscripted away to the Stormtrooper Academy, but Kip had learned how to lie low, to survive, to endure. Not until Han Solo's arrival, though, had he considered escape. Han showed that a small, determined group could break free of a prisoner's shackles. That they had stumbled into an even worse situation inside the Maw seemed irrelevant. Piloting the stolen shuttle, Kip had used his fledgling powers to steer them safely through the black hole cluster. In the years since the withered Vima Deboda had taught him the fundamentals of her Jedi skills, Kip had made little use of his own affinity for the Force. He remembered Vima Deboda's face as shrunken and leprous, and she had a habit of huddling in corners, of pulling shadows around herself as if to hide from immense prying eyes. The fallen Jedi had a guilty conscience that suffocated her like a blanket, but she had taken the time to teach Kip a few things before the Imperials whisked her away. "You have great potential," she had told him in one of her last brief lessons. Kip had paid little attention to that, until now. He stared fixedly at his untouched meal. Perhaps if he concentrated, focused his abilities on manipulating something, moving a tiny object, he could turn that skill into an escape. Escape. The word rang through his heart, conjuring images of hope. He was not certain how he did what he did. Sensing the best route through darkened spice tunnels seemed perfectly natural to him. When flying the shuttle through the fiery gas clouds, he had listened to the mysterious whispering voice directing him. Kip turned and altered course, spinning and whirling whenever it seemed right. But now that he needed to make use of the Force, he didn't know where to begin. He fixed his gaze on the flimsy foil covering of the instant meal, trying to bend it. He pushed with his mind, picturing the thin metal twisting and crumpling into a ball, but nothing happened. Kip wondered how much of Vima Deboda's ramblings had been simple superstition and craziness. His parents had no special sort of powers. On the Deer colony of the Anote system, they had both been outspoken local politicians. Upon hearing of a growing rebellion against the Emperor's rigid policies, they decided to work from within, speaking out against Palpatine to make him more moderate rather than overthrow him entirely. They resoundingly protested the destruction of Alderaan, but their efforts had only gotten the two of them and their sons Seth and Kip arrested. Kip remembered that night of terror, when the stormtroopers had melted down the door of the family dwelling even though it was unlocked. The armed soldiers marched into the living quarters, kicked over the fragile fiber-grown furniture. The stormtrooper captain read an arrest order through the filtered speaker in his helmet, accusing Kip's parents of treason. Then the stormtroopers drew their blasters and stunned the two astonished adults. Kip's older brother Zeth had tried to protect them, so the troopers stunned him as well. Kip, with tears streaming down his face, could only stare in disbelief at the three crumpled forms as the stormtroopers linked stun cuffs around his wrists. He still couldn't imagine how they had considered him a threat, since he had been only 8 years old at the time. Kip and his parents were taken to Kessel, while 14-year-old Zeth was hauled off as a brainwashed recruit to the Imperial Military Academy in Karida. They had never heard from Zeth again. After little more than a year, Kessel went into enormous internal upheavals, with prison revolts, the Imperials overthrown, slave lords taking over. Kip's parents had died during the commotion, executed for being on the wrong side at the wrong moment. Kip himself had survived by hiding, becoming silent and invisible. He had rotted in the darkness of the tunnels for 8 years, and now he had escaped. Only to be captured again. Somehow, it seemed, the Imperials were always there to wreck his aspirations. On Deer, the stormtroopers had stolen him away from his home, on Kessel they had thrown him into the spice mines. Now that he and Han had finally escaped, the stormtroopers had clamped around him again. Kip's anger focused into a projectile, and he tried again to use his ability on the meal tray. He pushed, and a drop of sweat fell into his eyes, blurring his vision. Had the tray moved, jerked a little. He saw a small dent in the textured protein patty that formed the main course. Had he done that? Perhaps anger was the key to focusing his latent energies. He wished Vima Deboda had spent more time instructing him down in the mines. He concentrated on the walls, on his narrow surroundings. He had to find some way of escaping. Han had already proved that it could be done. Kip vowed that if he did manage to get away, he would find someone to teach him how to use these mysterious powers. He never wanted to be left so helpless again. Looking at the delicate, bird-like Kwee-Zux, Han somehow could not imagine her as the developer of the Death Star. But she worked willingly in the Maw installation, and she had admitted her role in a matter-of-fact way. "What's a nice girl like you doing in a place like this?" he finally said. "This is what I do. This is what I'm best at." Kwee nodded her head absently, as if considering her answer. "Here I have a chance to grapple with the greatest mysteries of the cosmos, to solve problems that others have claimed are unsolvable. To see my wild ideas take shape. It's very thrilling." Han still could not understand. "But how did this happen to you? Why are you here?" "Oh, that," Kwee said, as if suddenly understanding the question. "My home planet was Amwat, in the Outer Rim. Moff Tarkin took 10 young Amwadi children from various cities. He placed us in intense forced education camps, trying to mold us into great designers and problem solvers. I was the best. I was the only one who made it through all the training. I was his prize, and he sent me here as a reward. At first I worked with Bevel Lemelisk to bring the Death Star to fruition. When we had the blueprints completed, Tarkin took Bevel away, leaving me to create newer and better concepts. Okay, Han said, so I'll ask you again, why do you do this stuff? Qui looked at him as if he had suddenly grown stupid. It's the most interesting thing I can imagine. I have my pick of the challenges, and I'm usually successful. What more could I want? Han knew he wasn't getting through. How can you enjoy working on things like this? It's horrible. Qui took another step backward, looking baffled and hurt. What do you mean by that? It's fascinating work, if you think about it. One of our concepts was to modify existing molecular furnace devices into autonomous world devastators that could strip raw materials from a planet's surface, feed it into huge automated onboard factories, and produce useful machines. We're quite proud of that idea. We transmitted the proposal off to Tarkin shortly after he took Bevel with him. Her voice trailed off. I wonder whatever happened to that idea. Han blinked in astonishment. The terrifying fleet of world devastators had attacked Admiral Ackbar's home planet, laying waste part of the beautiful water world before the juggernauts were destroyed. The world devastators have already been built, Han mumbled, and put to very efficient use. Qui's face lit up. Oh, that's wonderful. No, it isn't, he shouted into her face. She sprang back. Don't you know what your inventions are used for? Do you have any idea? Qui backed off, straightening up again defensively. Yes, of course. The Death Star was to be used to break up dead planets to allow direct mining of the heavy metals trapped in the core. The world devastators would be autonomous factories combing asteroids or sterile worlds to produce a wide range of items without polluting inhabited planets. Han snorted and rolled his eyes. If you believe that, you'll believe anything. Listen to their names. Death Star, World Devastator, that doesn't sound like something for peacetime economic development, does it? Qui scowled and turned her back on it. Oh, what difference does it make? The Death Star's first target was the planet Alderaan, my wife's home world. It murdered billions of innocent people. The world devastators were turned loose on the inhabited world of Calamari. Hundreds of thousands of people died. Those efficient factories of yours manufactured TIE fighters and other weapons of destruction, nothing else. I don't believe you. Her voice did not sound confident. I was there. I flew through the rubble of Alderaan, I saw the devastation on Calamari. Didn't you read about it in my interrogation report? Admiral Dalla pressed me over and over again for those details. Qui crossed her slender bluish arms over her chest. No, that wasn't in your debriefing summary, which you so melodramatically call an interrogation. Then you didn't get the whole report, Han said. Nonsense. I'm entitled to all data. She stared at her feet. Besides, I only develop the concepts. I make them work. If someone on the outside abuses my inventions, I can't be held responsible. That's beyond the scope of what I do. Han made a noncommittal sound, simmering with anger. Her words sounded rehearsed, like something that had been drilled into her. She didn't even seem to think about what she was saying. Qui flitted back to her 3D display panel, tapping on the musical keys and humming to sharpen the long, angular image she had been constructing when Han opened his eyes. Would you like to see what I'm working on now? Qui asked, studiously avoiding any mention of the previous discussion. Sure, Han said, afraid that when she no longer needed to talk to him, Qui would send him back to his detention cell. She gestured to the image of the small craft. Four-sided and elongated, it looked like the long shard of a fire facet gem. From the diagram he could see a pilot's compartment with space enough for six people. Small lasers studded strategic areas. The bottom of the long point carried a strange toroidal transmitting dish. "Right now we're working on enhancing the armor," Kui said. "Though the craft is not much larger than a single-man fighter, we need it to be completely impervious to attack. By introducing quantum crystalline armor, where only a few layers of atoms are stacked as densely as physics permits, laminated on top of another thin film just as tough but phase-shifted, we can be confident that nothing will harm it. Not so much as a dent." Han nodded to the laser emplacements. He couldn't see well from his vantage chained against a support pillar. "Then why add the weaponry if the ship is indestructible?" He had visions of a fleet of these things replacing the TIE fighters. A small force of indestructible assault craft could fly into any new Republic fleet and carve the ships up at their leisure. "This craft is highly maneuverable, and small enough not to be noticed on a system-wide scan, but they still might encounter some resistance. Remember, the Death Star was the size of a small moon. This accomplishes through finesse what the Death Star brought about through brute force." With a cold fear inside, Han did not want to know the answer to his next question. How could she compare this small ship to the Death Star? But he couldn't stop himself from asking, "And what is it? What does it do?" Kui looked at the image with awe, pride, and fear. "Well, we haven't actually tested it yet, but the first full-scale model is basically completed. We call this concept the Suncrusher, tiny but immensely powerful. One small, impervious craft launches a modulated resonance projectile into a star, which triggers a chain reaction in the core, igniting a supernova even in low-mass stars. Straightforward and simple." In his horror, Han could think of nothing to say. The Death Star destroyed planets, but the Suncrusher could destroy whole solar systems. Chapter 22. Luke and Lando stood with Morath Duel, high inside one of Kessel's atmosphere stacks. They held the rusted guard railing at the edge of a catwalk, staring down the dizzying drop. Leaning into the stack, they breathed the manufactured air boiling into the sky. It reminded Luke of the great air shaft in Cloud City. Duel shouted into the roaring background noise. "According to one old Imperial study, there's only enough raw material in Kessel's crust to keep the atmosphere in equilibrium for a century or two at our present rate of consumption." He shrugged, hunching his bumpy shoulders in a sort of seizure. "A few years ago the output was higher so that the slaves could walk around and breathe the air, but what's the point in allowing that?" Lando nodded sagely, as if still interested, while Luke said nothing. Duel had been their tour guide for an entire day, talking more than even the long-winded senators on Coruscant. Duel wanted Lando's 500,000 credits and went about extolling Kessel's virtues like a representative from the Planetary Chamber of Commerce. Wherever Duel took them, Luke strained his Jedi senses, reaching out to find some sign of Han or Chewbacca. But Luke could feel no tickle in the Force, no ripple of his friend's presence. Perhaps they were truly dead after all. Lando continued his conversation with Duel, shouting into the rushing wind that rose through the stack. "A lot can change around here by the time the air runs out. What matters is what you accomplish during your own lifetime." Duel's hissing laugh was swallowed by background noise. He reached up to lay a hand on Lando's shoulder. "We think alike, Mr. Timo. Who cares what happens after we're space dust? I'd rather squeeze Kessel dry while I've got it in my fist. You seem to have such an enormous operation. Why are you still running it solo?" Lando asked. Duel flinched at the term, solo, and Luke knew Lando had chosen his word carefully. Both of them caught the Rybet's reaction. "What do you mean?" Duel asked. "Well, when the Imperial confiscation of spice ended, I would have thought you'd open all your markets, get 1,000 representatives to spread the product. Jabba the Hutt is dead. Why didn't you link up with the unified smugglers under Talon Card and Mara Jade? That must have hurt your profits." Duel pointed one gummy-ended finger at Lando. "Our profits are growing enormously, now that we get all the glitter stem, rather than just what we can steal from under Imperial noses. And after being so long under the yoke of the Empire, I didn't want to get into the same position with the New Republic. Everybody knows that Jade and Card are just puppets. Seeing Lando's skepticism, Duel waved his hands. Oh, but we are considering it, of course. In fact, I've already spoken with a minister from the New Republic, opening up a line of communication that may eventually lead to an alliance. Sounds like good news, Lando said in a noncommittal voice. Duel led them back along the catwalk to the access doorway, where R2 waited. Shutting the heavy door behind them, Duel paused a moment for their ears to adjust to the sudden silence. As you can see, a great deal is changing around here. You, my friend, have chosen a good time to join in. If I decide to invest, Lando said firmly. Yes, yes, if you decide to invest. The truth is, this could be even more important, Mr. Timo. Since the death of Skinksnecks, I'll be needing a new assistant for running the spice mines. Lando fluffed the cape behind him in a self-important gesture. If I'm investing 500,000 credits, Duel, I'd expect to be more of a partner than an assistant. Duel practically kowtowed. Of course. Trivial details can be worked out. I'll also need a new shift boss. Maybe your companion here would be interested in the work. He looked at Luke, squinting with his egg-white eye. Luke met the Rybet's mechanical eye and stared into the focus-changing lenses, trying to pry some secrets from Duel's brain. Luke said, I'll have to think about it. Duel ignored him, focusing his attention back on Lando. Now then, you've seen practically everything. Is there anything else I can show you? Lando looked to Luke, who pondered a moment. Thoughts of the Jagged Moon and its security base kept troubling him. If Han was not on Kessel itself, perhaps he was imprisoned on the moon base. Aren't you worried about attack from remnants of the Empire? Luke asked. Or consolidation forces from the New Republic? Duel brushed aside the comment. We have our own defenses. Don't worry. But Luke persisted, trying to sound like a cautious business associate. If we're going to invest, we should see these alleged defenses. We know about the energy shield left by the Imperial Correction Facility. But do you have a fleet of any sort? Duel began to sputter, but Lando took charge. Morith, if there's something you don't want us to see. No, no, it's no trouble at all. I'll just have to arrange a shuttle up to the moon base. I don't want you to think we have anything to hide. Duel bustled off to arrange for the shuttle, leaving Luke and Lando to exchange skeptical glances. Lando did not like the idea of leaving the Lady Luck behind on the landing pad of the Imperial Correction Facility, but Duel continued to play the gracious host. Luke silently tried to console him as they lifted off in the short-range shuttle, but Lando kept looking out the small window as if he would never see his ship again. Kessel's moon approached, looking like a hollowed sphere with most of the rock scooped out to house a large internal hangar and the enormous generators and transmitters that created the protective energy shields surrounding the planet. After they landed, Morith Duel strutted out of the shuttle, gesturing them to follow with an impatience that made Luke curious. Duel stood waiting for them as R2 worked his way down the ramp and into the giant grotto. Behind a transparent atmosphere containment screen, Luke could see stars and the trailing wisps of gas looping around the black hole cluster. Duel seemed prouder of his defensive fleet than he was of any other aspect of the Kessel operations. Follow me. He waddled across the rock floor of the hangar bay, leading them along rows and rows of fighter craft arranged in seemingly random order. They passed ships Luke found familiar and others so exotic he could not even identify them. He called on his knowledge as a fighter pilot to assess the fleet. X-wings, Y-wings, powerful Corellian corvettes, a single B-wing, TIE fighters, TIE interceptors, 4 TIE bombers, several skip-ray blast boats, gamma-class assault shuttles. In space, like prizes around the ragged opening of the moon, hovered larger attack ships, 3 Carrick cruisers, 2 big Lancer frigates, a single Lorimer strike cruiser. After we drove out the Empire, Duel said, I placed the highest priority on a defensive fleet. I bought every fighter I could find, no matter what its condition, and hired experienced mechanics from the Corellian sector of Nar Shaddaa. He grinned with his amphibian lips. We just got the energy shield operational again 2 days ago. I can heave a big sigh of relief now. With the shields finally up and our new fleet as a backup, Kessel is safe and independent. We can set glitterstem prices across the galaxy without interference from anybody. Sure is a lot of ships, Lando agreed. I'm impressed. Luke recalled how much trouble the New Republic had, obtaining sufficient fighting ships during Admiral Thrawn's guerrilla campaigns. If Morath Duel had been pulling all the strings he could to obtain every functional ship in the sector, no wonder supplies had been so limited. We should be able to defend against spice pirates, don't you think? Duel said. They kept walking along the rows of parked ships. Suddenly Lando froze, and Luke felt a surge of shocked emotion from him. R2 began chittering wildly. Luke looked around until he saw one modified light freighter of Corellian manufacture, a ship that looked decidedly familiar. What is it? Duel asked, looking down at the droid. Lando took a moment to regain his composure. He rapped his knuckles on R2's top dome. Stray cosmic ray, I suppose. Occasionally these old astromech units frazzle a circuit. He swallowed. Could I speak with my assistant for a moment in private, Morath? Of course. Duel discreetly backed away. I'll go make sure the mechanics are prepping the shuttle for our return to Kessel. He turned to Luke and forced humor into his tone. Now, don't go talking your boss out of making an investment here. The moment Duel moved out of earshot, Lando nodded excitedly to the freighter. That's the Falcon, Luke. I know her, like a crabex knows its shell. Luke looked at the ship, recognizing it himself but wanting more proof. You positive? It's the Falcon, Luke. I owned her, remember, before Han stole her from me in a sabacc game. If you look, you can see the streaking scar on top where I knocked off the subspace antenna dish trying to zip away from the Death Star. Luke also noticed scorch marks from a recent space combat. They could have changed the markings, wiped the memory core. Is there any other way we can prove it? Just get me inside the cockpit. Hans made some modifications to the ship nobody else would know about. When Duel returned, Lando said, my assistant wants to be sure you've been doing thorough maintenance on these ships. If you're not taking care of them, they don't make much of a defensive fleet. Let's take a look inside one at random, say, that Corellian ship over there. Duel seemed taken by surprise, glancing at the Falcon. That one? We have plenty of top-notch fighters you can check out. That one is something of a piece of junk. Lando waggled his finger. If you choose the ship for us, Morath, that contradicts the whole point of a random inspection, doesn't it? Open this one up. Go on. Reluctantly, Duel worked the external controls that dropped the Falcon's ramp. Lando took the lead, followed by Luke, while R2 puttered so closely behind Duel that he nearly ran over the Rybet's heels. Inside, Lando strode to the cockpit, ostensibly to check out the systems. Running his fingers lovingly over the stained, worn surfaces, he flicked a few switches. Ion flux stabilizer checks out as optimal, so does the stasis field generator. Should we go back and check out the power converter? Those things are notorious for breaking down in Corellian freighters. Lando backed down the narrow corridor leading from the cockpit to the central living section of the ship. Turning left toward the entry ramp, he stepped carefully on the main deck plates. From the control panels he had unlatched the hidden locks, and when he stomped on the appropriate plates with his boot heel, they popped up, revealing the 7 secret compartments Han had personally installed as spice smuggling bins beneath the floor. Caught you, Duel, you bastard. Lando grabbed him by the yellow cravat at his throat. What have you done with Han and Chewbacca? Duel seemed completely astonished, flailing his splayed hands in the air. What are you talking about? He croaked. As Lando glared down into the Rybet's huge eyes, Duel slipped one of his hands into his waistcoat and yanked free a small, holdout blaster pistol. Luke saw it and reacted instantly, shoving with his mind and using the force to hurl Morath Duel away from Lando. The blaster went off, sending a deadly beam ricocheting around the Falcon's corridor. Duel fell backward, then scrambled to his feet. He fired at them again, but his mechanical eye had no time to focus, and the beam went wide. Duel dove down the ramp, bellowing for the guards. His mechanical eye fell off, clanging and rolling across the floor. He scrambled after it in a panic, feeling blindly with his hands. Luke smacked the door controls, raising the ramp and sealing the hatch. "We should have kept him as a hostage," he said. "Now it's going to be a lot more difficult to get out of here." Outside, Duel raised the alarm. Guards scrambled through the parked ships, drawing blasters, fastening their armor. "R2, get to the computer," Luke said. Lando jumped into the chair behind the controls. "I doubt we can do anything for Han anymore. We need to get back and tell Leia. She can bring a full-scale occupation force to Kessel. We'll go over this place with a high-res scanner. If we get out of here alive," Luke said. "R2," Lando called, "jack into the co-pilot's computer and tie into the hangar controls." The astromech droid chittered his willingness to help, and rolled toward the Navicomp console. Outside in the hangar, security horns sounded. People ran around every which direction, not knowing where to go. Luke saw immediately that these mercenaries had far less experience working together than the sloppiest Imperial regiment. But the moment Lando lifted the ship off the landing pad floor, everyone had an unmistakable target. "R2, get that door field down," Lando shouted. Using maneuvering thrusters, he edged the ship forward, picking up speed as they rose over the other parked fighters. Pilots scrambled into their ships, ready for a space battle. In orbit around the moon, the capital ships did not yet seem aware of the situation. Lando accelerated toward the wide hangar opening to space. They could not see the invisible shield. R2 bleeped and whistled, but the sounds were not positive. "Get the shield down," Lando insisted. R2's interface jack whirred as he worked with the hangar bay's computer, trying to skirt the password controls. "We need the shield down now, R2," Luke said. The Falcon's rear thrusters kicked in and they lurched forward, gaining speed. "Come on," Lando said to the ship. "You can do it. Do it one last time for Han." R2 bleeped in triumph a moment before they shot through the opening. Luke flinched, but the shield dropped just in time. Alert lights began to wink on in the big battleships riding in orbit. Weapon systems warmed up, targeting modules locked on to aim points. The Millennium Falcon soared into open space, as behind them, the Kessel forces scrambled in pursuit. Chapter 23. Hunched in his dark robes, Tol Siverin came to visit Kwee-Zux in her research room. He drew in a long, hissing breath, and his head tails twitched with uneasiness as he stared at her setup. The Twi'lek administrator gave the impression of never having set foot inside an actual laboratory before, which seemed odd to Kwee, since he was in charge of the entire installation. Kwee stopped her musical calculation with an atonal squawk. "Director Siverin. What can I do for you?" Tol Siverin demanded regular written reports, feasibility studies, and progress summaries. He hosted a weekly meeting among the scientists to share their ideas and their work in a frank and stimulating exchange. But Tol Siverin did not make a habit of visiting. He shuffled around the room, poking at things, kneading his knuckles, and looking at the standard equipment as if deeply interested. He brushed his clawed fingertips over the calibration gauge of a weld stress analyzer, muttering, "Good work," as if Kwee herself had invented the common instrument. "I just came to commend you for your consistently fine efforts, Dr. Zux." Siverin stroked one of the vermiform headtails draped around his neck, then his voice grew stern. "But I hope you are about finished with your endless iterations on the Suncrusher project. We're past Grand Moff Tarkin's target date, you know, and we must move soon. I insist you write your final report and get all the documentation in order. Submit it to my office as soon as possible. Qui blinked at him in annoyance. She had submitted 5 separate, final, reports already, but each time Sivrin had asked her to rerun a particular simulation or to retest the structural welds in the Suncrusher's quantum armor. He never gave any reasons, and Qui got the impression that he never read the reports anyway. If it had been up to her, the Suncrusher would have been ready for deployment 2 years ago. She was getting bored with it, wanting to move on to a new design she could start from scratch, and get back to the enjoyable, imaginative work again. You'll have the report by this evening, Director Sivrin. She would just send a repeat of the last one. Good, good, Sivrin said, stroking his head tail again. I just wanted to make sure everything is in order. For what? Qui thought. We're not going anywhere. She hated it when the administrators and the military types kept sticking their noses in her work. Without another word, Tol Sivrin left. Qui stared after him, then activated the rarely used privacy lock on her door. Returning to her imaging terminal, she continued trying to crack the wall of passwords in front of her. She did like challenges, after all. Qui could not stop thinking about what Han Solo had told her. At first it was a new puzzle to solve, but then she finally began paying attention. To her, all the prototypes she developed were abstract concepts turned into reality through mathematical music and brilliant intuitions. She kept telling herself that she did not know, or care, what her inventions were used for. She could certainly guess, but she tried not to. She didn't want to know. She blocked those thoughts before they could surface. But Qui Zux wasn't stupid. The Death Star was supposed to be used to break apart depleted, dead planets to provide access to raw materials deep in the core. Right. Had she thought up that excuse afterward? The World Devastators were supposed to be immense wandering factories taking useless rubble and fabricating scores of valuable industrial components. Right. Tarkin had been with her during the immense pressure of her original training. She knew what the man was capable of. And the new Suncrusher was, what? Han had said, raising his voice so that it hurt her fragile ears. What in all the galaxy could the Suncrusher be used for other than to completely wipe out all life in systems the Imperials don't like? You don't even have a bogus excuse like rubble mining. The Suncrusher has one purpose only, to bring death to countless innocent people. Nothing more. But Qui could not possibly have the responsibility for lives on her hands. That wasn't part of her job. She just drew up blueprints, toyed with designs, solved equations. It exhilarated her to discover something previously considered impossible. On the other hand, she was perfectly aware of what she was doing, though feigned naivete provided such a nice excuse, such a perfect shield against her own conscience. In the Maw databanks, Qui had discovered the complete debriefing of Han Solo, protected by a password she had easily broken, full video instead of just a transcription. Sivrin and Dala had indeed kept much of it from her, but why? As Qui watched the entire torture session, she could not believe her eyes. She had never suspected the information had been taken from him in that manner. The words on paper seemed so cool and cooperative. But on a deeper, professional level, she was outraged at Admiral Dala. Access to data was supposedly open to all Maw scientists. She had never been denied a single information request in 12 years inside the black hole cluster. But this was even worse. She hadn't just been denied access to the full report, she had been deceived into thinking Han's debriefing held no more data. But information is meant to be shared, Qui thought. How can I do my work if I don't have the pertinent data? Qui had little trouble breaking through the various passwords. Apparently, no one had expected her to bother looking. She read the full report with sickened astonishment: the destruction of Alderaan, the attack on Yavin 4, the ambush of the rebel fleet over Endor, the huge hospital ship and personnel carriers blown into micrometeoroids by the second Death Star's superlaser. What did you think they were going to be used for? Han had said. Qui closed her eyes to the thought. Focus on the problem. It had been a mantra of her childhood. Be distracted by nothing else. Solving the problem was the only important thing. Solving the problem meant survival itself. As a child, she remembered spending 2 years in the sterile, silent environment of the orbital education sphere above her homeworld of Amwat. Qui had been 10 standard years old, the same age as her other 9 companions, each selected from different Amwati honeycomb settlements. From orbit, the orange and green continents looked surreal, blurred by clouds and dimpled with canyons, blemished by upthrust mountains, nothing like the clean maps she had seen before. But beside Qui's educational sphere, orbited Moff Tarkin's personal Star Destroyer. It had been a mere victory-class ship, but powerful enough to rain death and ruin down on Amwat if the students should fail. For 2 years, life for Qui had been an endless succession of training, testing, training, testing, with no other purpose than to cram the total knowledge of engineering disciplines into pliable young Amwati minds, or to burst their brains in the process. Tarkin's research had shown that Amwati children were capable of amazing mental feats, if pushed properly and sufficiently. Most of the young minds would collapse under the pressure, but some emerged like precious jewels, brilliant and creative. Moff Tarkin had wanted to test that possibility. The gaunt, steel-hard man had stood in his dress uniform during important examinations, staring at the surviving Amwati children as they wrestled with problems that had stymied the Empire's best designers. Qui remembered how alarmed they had been when one of her classmates, a young male named Pillock, suddenly fell to the floor in some kind of seizure, grasping his head and screaming. He managed to climb to his knees, weeping, before the guards grabbed him. He still grasped for his examination paper as they hauled him away, yelling that he wanted to finish his work. In silence, Qui and her 3 surviving classmates went to the window of the educational sphere, so they could watch as turbolasers from the Victory-class Star Destroyer obliterated Pillock's honeycomb settlement, in punishment for his failure. Qui could not be distracted by consequences. If her concentration faltered, everyone would die. She had to lock away all caring. Problems were pure, and safe, to be solved for their own sake. She could not allow herself to think beyond the abstract challenge at hand. In the end, Qui had been the only one of her group who made it through the training. She received no instruction in biological sciences, saving her memory space for more physics, mathematics, and engineering. Tarkin had whisked her off to the new Maw installation and placed her under the tutelage of the great engineer Bevel Lemelisk. Qui had been in the Maw ever since. Problems had to be solved for their own sake. If she allowed herself to be distracted by feelings, terrible things would happen. She remembered images of burning Amwati cities winking like faraway campfires from orbit, the laser-ignited wildfires that swept across the savannas of her world. But she had too many calculations to finish, too many designs to modify. Qui had salved her conscience by laying the responsibility on others. But the truth was, she created devices that had directly caused the deaths of entire civilizations, the destruction of whole worlds. With the Suncrusher, she could wipe out solar systems with the push of a button. Qui Zux had a lot of thinking to do, but she didn't know how to go about this kind of pondering. This was an entirely new and different type of problem to solve. Chewbacca stood like a statue, refusing to move, and daring the keeper to use his power lash again. The keeper did. Chewbacca roared at the pain lancing across his skin, his nerves writhed in the aftermath of the charge. He raised his hairy arms, seething with the desire to rip the fat, placid man's limbs from his spherical torso. 14 stormtroopers leveled their blasters at him. Are you going back to work, Wookiee, or do I have to nudge the power setting up a couple more notches? The keeper tapped the handle of the power lash against his palm, gazing at Chewbacca with a bland expression. His complexion was dusty-looking and bloodless, as if no hint of life had ever passed beneath the skin. Any other time I might have enjoyed the challenge of breaking you, Wookiee. I've been here 14 standard years with an entire crew of Wookiee slaves. We lost a few during the process, but I cracked them all, and now they follow orders and do their work. But Admiral Dalla insists that everything be in top-notch condition for mobilization by tomorrow. He flicked the sizzling green tip of the lash in the air in front of Chewbacca's face, singeing some of the fur. Chewbacca peeled back his black lips and growled. "I don't have time to play games right now," the keeper said. "If I have to waste any more time disciplining you, I'm going to dump you out into space. Do you understand?" Chewbacca considered roaring in his face, but the keeper looked serious. At the very least, Chewbacca had to survive long enough to find out what had happened to Han. A long time ago, Han had rescued Chewbacca from other enslavers, and he still owed the man a life debt. He gave a low grunt of acquiescence. "Good, now get back to that assault shuttle." Chewbacca wore gray work coveralls with pockets to hold engine diagnostic tools and hydrospanners. None of the tools could be used as a weapon, Chewbacca had already checked that much out. The Gamma-class assault shuttle took up a good portion of the Gorgon's lower hangar bay. Chewbacca had a small databoard listing the configurations for the tractor beam projector and the deflector shield generators. He had worked on other ships before, and he knew the Falcon inside out thanks to the many on-the-spot repairs he and Han had been forced to make. With the specs on the databoard, he could easily service decades-old Imperial technology. On the rear of the assault shuttle, Chewbacca checked the exhaust nozzles of the thrust reactors and grudgingly tested the blaster cannon mountings. In the front of the vessel, a convenient boarding hatch allowed access for the command crew, but Chewbacca opted for the more rigorous method of popping open and climbing through one of the foldaway launch doors used to disgorge zero-G stormtroopers during a space assault. Inside, he had access to the engineering level, where he tinkered with the power modulators and the life support systems. He restrained his urge to rip out circuits and damage the equipment. The keeper would execute him immediately, and such a minor sabotage would accomplish nothing. Even subtle damage was likely to be discovered in the initial checkout procedure. The assault shuttle's Spartan passenger section held only benches for its complement of space troopers, as well as power-coupled storage compartments for their bulky zero-G armor. Up front, Chewbacca powered up and checked out the command console, did a test run of the twin tandem flight computers, and thought about uprooting the chairs on which the five members of the command crew would sit. Outside in the Gorgon's hangar bay, the fat keeper shouted and lashed at the air. Chewbacca felt a surge of anger upon hearing cries of agony from the other cowed Wookiee slaves. He knew nothing about his fellow captives, he had been held in a separate cell, and they were not allowed to speak to each other. Chewbacca wondered how long it had been since these exhausted slaves had touched the branches of their home trees. "Get working," the keeper yelled. "We have a lot that needs to be done today. 300 ships on the Gorgon alone." And Chewbacca knew the three other Star Destroyers had an equal number of TIE fighters, blast boats, and assault shuttles. Chewbacca clenched his fist around an upraised storage lid, bending it noticeably. He wanted to know why Admiral Dalla insisted on such desperate speed. Queezux did not like to be muscled around by stormtroopers. In her years at the Maw installation, she had learned to ignore the rigid troopers marching around the corridors in white armor, in endless robotic training formations that made no sense at all. Did they all have faulty memories, or what? Once she learned something, she didn't need to keep drilling, drilling, drilling. Kui paid little attention to them anymore, until a squad marched into her laboratory and insisted that she follow them. Only moments earlier, Kui had shut down her illicit database searches, and she had disengaged the privacy lock on her lab's entryway. She had no reason to think the stormtroopers suspected anything, but she still felt unreasoning terror. The troopers folded around her in a protective bubble as they marched her along the tiled corridors. "Where are you taking me?" Kui finally managed to ask. "Admiral Dalla wishes to see you," the captain said through the filtered speaker on his helmet. "Oh. Why? She'll have to tell you that herself." Kui swallowed a cold lump in her throat and put a haughty tone in her voice. "Why couldn't she come to me herself?" "Because Admiral Dalla is a busy person. I'm a busy person, too. She is our commanding officer. You aren't. Qui asked no further questions but followed in silence as they took her across an access tube to another asteroid in the main conglomeration, then aboard a small shuttle in the landing bay. When they arrived aboard the Star Destroyer Gorgon, Qui could not keep herself from staring in wide-eyed fascination. Though the enormous ships had hung in the sky above Maw installation for as long as she could remember, Qui rarely had an opportunity to board them. Her stormtrooper escorts took her directly to the Gorgon's bridge. The trapezoidal command tower rose high above the arrowhead-shaped main body, giving a panoramic view overlooking the vast landscape of the ship. Qui stood and stared out the front viewport toward the cobbled-together collection of rocks that made up Maw installation. For a moment she remembered watching from the orbiting educational sphere as Moff Tarkin obliterated Amwadi cities far below. Command crew bustled about their stations, intent on their work as if in the middle of an important drill. In the corridors stormtroopers marched by at a brisk pace. Overlapping intercom messages peppered the air. Qui wondered how the troops could be so busy after a decade of doing nothing. Admiral Dalla stood by her command console, staring at the deadly swirling gases that blocked her from the outside. Qui saw her trim, perfect figure masked by an aurora of chestnut hair that flowed like a living blanket down her back. When Dalla turned to face her, some of the hair remained where it hung, wrapping around her waist while other strands arced behind her. "You wanted to see me?" Qui asked. Her reedy voice quavered despite her efforts to control her nervousness. Dalla looked at her for a moment, and Qui had the impression of being placed under a magnifying lens in preparation for dissection. Then Dalla suddenly seemed to recognize her. "Ah. You are Qui Zux, in charge of the Suncrusher project?" "Yes, Admiral." She paused a moment, then blurted, "Have I done something wrong?" "I don't know." "Have you?" Dalla answered, then turned back to the broad window, staring out at her other ships. "I can't get any straight information out of Tol Sivrin, so I'll tell you directly. If you have any further work to do on your Suncrusher, finish it now. We are mobilizing the fleet." Dalla misinterpreted Qui's shocked silence. "Don't worry, I'll authorize whatever assistance you need, but everything must be done within a day. You've had 2 years longer than Grand Moff Tarkin gave you. It is time to put the Suncrusher to use." Qui took a deep breath, trying to keep her thoughts from spinning. "But why now? Why such a rush?" Dalla whirled back at her, wearing a sour expression. "We have received new information. The Empire lies wounded and vulnerable on the outside, and we can't just sit here and wait. We have 4 Star Destroyers, a full fleet the Rebellion knows nothing about. Since the Death Star prototype is not capable of hyperspace travel, it is useless to us in this operation, but we will have the Suncrusher. Your beautiful Suncrusher." The lights of the fiery gases outside glimmered in Dalla's eyes. "With it we can destroy the New Republic, system by system." All of Han's warnings echoed as loud as screams in Qui's head. He had been right about everything. Dalla dismissed her, and Qui stumbled as the stormtroopers escorted her back toward the waiting shuttle. Qui would have to make her decision, sooner than she had expected. Chapter 24. In her own quarters, images of planets scrolled in front of Leia's eyes. Statistics, populations, resources, cold data that she had to absorb and assess to make her decision. She rejected most of the worlds out of hand, others she marked as possibilities. So far nothing had jumped out at her as the perfect place for Luke to establish his Jedi Academy. It hadn't seemed like such a difficult request, since the New Republic encompassed so many possible planets. She had found Dantooine as a new home for the survivors from Eol Shah. Why was an academy site causing her so much trouble? After meeting Luke's first 2 trainees and seeing how unusual they were, Leia suspected the Jedi studies would require complete isolation. She had spoken again to Gantoris and Streen in the past day and was discouraged to find both of them feeling miserable and abandoned. If only Luke would come back soon, with Han. As she thought of other places, Leia pondered how Yoda had trained Luke on the swampy planet of Dagobah, a place completely devoid of other intelligent life. Her brother would want someplace similar for his own trainees. Okay, what about Dagobah itself, she thought, putting a fingertip on her lower lip. The swamps had hidden Yoda for centuries, and it was certainly isolated from the mainstream of galactic traffic, but Dagobah had no appropriate facilities either. They would have to erect an academy from scratch. Mobilizing the New Republic construction forces, Leia could get the job done in short order, but she wasn't sure that was the right answer. Somehow she felt the right site would jump out at her. Because the restoration of the Jedi Knights meant so much, Luke would be very selective about the proper site. She just hadn't found it yet. The message center buzzed. Again. Though it was barely mid-morning, she had already lost count of the interruptions. With a sigh, Leia answered it, seeing the image of another minor functionary take shape in the central focus. Minister Organa Solo, the functionary said, I'm sorry to call you at home, but we need you to decide on a meal selection for the Bimini banquet. The deadline is today. The choices are grazer fillets with tart sauce, Nerf medallions with sweet fungi, broiled dewback. I'll take the Nerf medallions. Thank you. She switched off the receiver, then calmed herself before returning to the images of the planets. In the bedchambers, Jason burst into loud sobs, joined in a moment by his sister. 3PO cooed sounds of consolation, then began another one of his lullabies, which set them to crying louder. Part of Leia wanted to hurry into the children's room to see what was the matter, while another part of her just wanted to seal their door so she could have a little more quiet. On the morning after the reception at the Skydome Botanical Gardens, both children had come down with a cold. Slight fever, congestion, and general crankiness, the type of frequent minor illness the twins would no doubt suffer for another few years, but Leia didn't want to just abandon them to the care of 3PO. After some refresher programming, the protocol droid had proved himself capable of caring for the two-year-olds. But Leia felt a defensiveness in herself. She was their mother. While it was a new set of responsibilities for her, Leia did not want a droid to watch them all the time, no matter how competent his programming. The children had already spent so much of their lives with Winter that Leia wanted to make up for lost time, if her political duties would only give her the chance. Before she could call up the file on another planet to consider, the message center buzzed again. What is it? She said, mustering every scrap of civility she still possessed. She did not recognize the alien administrator in the image. Ah, Minister Organa Solo, I am calling from the office of the Deputy Assistant Minister of Industry. I was told you might be able to offer a suggestion about a type of music that would be appropriate to play during the arrival of the Ishi-Tib delegate. For a moment Leia reconsidered her time as a prisoner of Jabba the Hutt. At least the slug-like crime lord had not required her to do anything more than sit there and look beautiful. Before she finished signing off, a message came in from Admiral Akbar. Though she liked the Calamarian admiral, she found it difficult to keep her temper from boiling. How was she supposed to get anything done with all these interruptions? Hello, Admiral, can I help you quickly? I'm in the middle of a rather large project right now. Akbar nodded graciously, swiveling his big fish eyes to the front in a gesture of courtesy. Of course, Leia. I apologize for the interruption, but I'd like to solicit your comments on the speech I have just written. As you remember, I am giving it before the cabinet tomorrow, and you agreed to provide me with data on the rezoning of embassy sectors in the devastated areas of Imperial City. I did write the speech without your input, but I need to have the information before tomorrow. I've marked clearly where you need to add your thoughts. Would it be possible? Of course, Admiral. I'm sorry I haven't been more attentive. Please send it to my personal network address, and I'll get to it right away. I promise. Akbar nodded his salmon-colored head. Thank you, and I apologize again for the interruption. I'll let you get back to work. When he signed off, Leia could do no more than sit with her eyes closed, hoping for a few moments of silence. In quiet times, though, she began to worry too much about Han. The door chime sounded. Leia almost screamed. Mon Mothma stood at the doorway in her flowing white robes. "Hello, Leia. Do you mind if I come in?" Leia stuttered, trying to regain her composure. Please. Mon Mothma had never come visiting, never shown the slightest inclination to make any sort of social call. Though calm and quietly charismatic, the chief of state had always distanced herself from anyone else. During the early days of the rebellion, Mon Mothma had sparred with Leia's father Bail Organa on the floor of the Senate. Mon Mothma was a new senator then, a firebrand insisting on rapid and sweeping changes that dismayed the seasoned and cynical Bail Organa. Eventually, though, they joined forces to oppose Senator Palpatine in his quest to become president. When they failed and Palpatine proclaimed himself emperor, Mon Mothma began to speak of open rebellion. A horrified Bail Organa had not seen the need until after the Gorman massacre, when he finally realized that the Republic he had served for so long was truly dead. The death of Bail Organa and the destruction of Alderaan had affected Mon Mothma deeply. But she had never hinted that she wished to become friends with the daughter of her old rival. "What can I do for you, Mon Mothma?" Leia asked. Mon Mothma looked around the private quarters, fixing her gaze on the sweeping landscapes of Alderaan mounted on the walls, the grasslands, the organic-looking tower cities, the underground settlements. The faintest sheen of tears seemed to film her eyes. "I learned that your children are sick, and I wanted to offer my consolations." She fixed a sharp gaze on Leia. "And I have also learned that Han and Chewbacca never returned from their Kessel mission. I wish you hadn't tried to hide that from me. Is there anything I can do?" Leia looked down. "No. Lando Calrissian and my brother Luke have already gone to see what they can find. I hope they bring back news soon." Mon Mothma nodded. "And I also wanted to commend you on the job you are doing. Or perhaps console you is the better word." Leia could not hide her surprise. The reception for Ambassador Fergan was a disaster. Mon Mothma shrugged. "And do you think anyone could have performed better than you did? You did a perfectly adequate job with the Keridans. Some battles simply cannot be won. Given the Keridans' potential for galactic mayhem, I think getting a drink thrown in my face is a relatively minor debacle." With a faint smile, Leia had to admit that the Chief of State was right. "Now, if only I could find a place to house Luke's Jedi Academy, I'd feel like I'm making some progress through this whole morass." Mon Mothma smiled. "I've been thinking about that too, ever since Luke made his speech. I believe I have a suggestion." Leia's dark eyes widened in surprise. "Please." Mon Mothma indicated the data terminal in Leia's living chamber. "May I?" Leia gestured for her to use the system. Though a lifelong politician, Mon Mothma set to work on the database, she was obviously no stranger to doing her own research. When images of the new planet crystallized in the projection zone, Leia felt the tingle of excitement creep through her. The confident feeling that this was the right place grew in her heart. She wondered how she had overlooked something so obvious. "Consider," Mon Mothma said, smiling. "It has everything he could possibly need: privacy, good climate, facilities already in place. It's perfect. I don't know why I didn't think of it myself." The message center buzzed again. "What?" Leia barked at the caller. She realized she should have been more restrained, but she had reached the end of her fuse. Mon Mothma remained at the data terminal, watching from outside the field of view. The caller also dispensed with tact. "We need your report right now, Minister Organa Solo. The Orbital Debris Committee is deliberating on the disposition of wreckage around Coruscant. You were supposed to attend our discussions this morning." Leia recognized the functionary as Ander, the vice chairman of the committee. "My aide has already cancelled my appointments for today. I'm sorry I was unable to attend." "We received your cancellation, but we didn't receive your report. You agreed to write a summary and distribute it to us at this session. It's past due. sick children do not make the New Republic stop functioning. Seeing red, Leia remembered standing in Jabba's palace, holding the pulsing thermal detonator in her hand, waiting for it to explode and kill them all. 5, 4, 3, 2. Somehow she restrained herself. Perhaps spending a day with Ambassador Fergan had toughened her calluses. I may be the Minister of State, Mr. Ander, but I am also a mother. I have to do both jobs, I can't sacrifice one for the sake of the other. My children need me now. The committee can wait. Miffed, the vice chairman raised his voice. It would have been much easier to complete our deliberations if you had been here rather than home playing nurse. Couldn't you hire a medical droid to take care of your kids' runny noses? This is an important issue we're dealing with, affecting the fate of all space traffic approaching and leaving Coruscant. Leia stiffened. This is an important issue I'm dealing with here, too. How can you expect me to care about the whole galaxy if I don't even care for my own family? If you wanted mindless devotion to duty without caring about people, then you should have stayed with the old Empire. She reached for the controls. My report will be issued to you in due time, Mr. Ander. She switched him off before he could say another word. At the end of her outburst, Leia slumped into her self-conforming chair, suddenly remembering her guest. Her face turned scarlet with embarrassment. That committee meets weekly, and there's no reason why they couldn't have waited until next time, she said in a simmering, defensive voice. I'm really not going to let any important negotiations go down the drain. I know my duty. Mon Mothma nodded, sharing one of her placid, heartfelt smiles. Of course you won't, Leia. I understand. Don't worry about it. The Chief of State looked at Leia with what seemed to be a new and surprising respect. Leia sighed and stared at the planetary image on the data terminal. Maybe I should go off and spend a few months at the Jedi Academy myself as soon as Luke gets it underway, though I know that'll never happen. Taking a vacation from Imperial City is about as easy as walking away from a black hole. Affairs of state swallow up my entire day. She caught herself complaining and quickly added, but of course restoring the order of the Jedi Knights is very important. I have the potential to use the Force and so do the twins. But thorough training will take a lot of time and concentration, two commodities I don't seem to have. Mon Mothma looked at her gravely, then squeezed Leia's shoulder. Don't worry too much. You have other important things in store for you. Chapter 25. Han rolled over with a groan in the detention cell. The hard ridges on the surface of his bunk, Han thought of them as discomfort stripes, made sleep itself a nightmare. He awoke from a dream about Leia, perhaps the only enjoyment he had experienced in 3 weeks. The dim reddish light filtered down, hurting his eyes without providing useful illumination. He blinked his eyes open, hearing people move outside his cell door, the clank of stormtrooper boots on the floor gratings, muffled voices. The cyberlock clicked as someone activated the password code. He sat up, suddenly alert. His body ached, his mind still buzzed from the interrogation drugs, but he tensed as the door opened. He had no idea what this was, but he felt certain he wouldn't like it. Corridor light flooded in, and Kwee-Zux stood beside an armed stormtrooper. She looked battered and abused by her own thoughts, which gave Han a smug grin. He hoped she had lost a lot of sleep after learning of the devastating use to which her inventions had been put. She might be able to fool herself, but she couldn't fool him. What, have you come back to discuss a few more moral issues, Doc? Am I supposed to be your conscience? Kwee crossed her pale bluish arms over her chest. Admiral Dalla has given me permission to interrogate you again, she said coldly, though her body language did not match her tone. She turned to the guard, her pearlescent hair sparkling in the dim corridor. Would you accompany me inside for the interrogation, Lieutenant? I'm afraid the prisoner might not cooperate. Yes, Dr. Zux, the guard said, following her into the cell. He slid the door partially closed behind him. While his back was turned, Qui withdrew a blaster from the utility pocket on her smock, pointed it at the guard, and fired a stun blast. Rippling arcs of blue fire surrounded him, then faded as he crumpled to the floor. Han leaped to his feet. "What are you doing?" Qui stepped over the fallen stormtrooper. The previous day she had seemed more fragile, the Imperial-issue heavy blaster pistol looked huge in her delicate hand. "Admiral Dalla is mobilizing this entire fleet in less than a day. She plans to take the Suncrusher and her four Star Destroyers to wipe out the New Republic. Your friend Kip Duran is also scheduled for termination this afternoon." She raised her feathery eyebrows. "Does that add up to enough of an excuse to escape as soon as we can?" Han's mind reeled. At the moment all he could think of was seeing Kip and Chewbacca again, then getting back to Coruscant so he could be reunited with Leia and the twins. "I don't have any appointments I couldn't be persuaded to cancel." "Good," Qui said. "Any questions?" Han smirked as he began to pull on his disguise of stormtrooper armor. "No, I'm used to doing this sort of thing." Kip could sense the difference in the air, his first indication that his efforts to focus the Force were actually accomplishing something. He studied every slight change in air currents, in the sluggish odors around the cell, the myriad tiny sounds that echoed through the metal walls. Stretching his mind through invisible webs of the Force, Kip could feel a surge from the guards when they walked past his cell. He could sense a twinge each time someone dispensed the food tray through the door. But their attitudes had changed. Over the whole ship he could catch faint ripples of activity, tension, growing anxiety. Something was about to happen. Closer at hand, he understood a deeper gut-wrenching truth. The emotions had been so clear in the guard station beside his door the previous sleep period. Kip Duran was not to be part of whatever activity the Star Destroyers were preparing. A young man from the spice mines of Kessel could provide no useful information, they had no reason to keep him alive. Admiral Dalla had already scheduled Kip's termination. He had not much longer to live. His lips curled back in an angry snarl. The Empire had been trying to destroy him all his life, and now they were about to succeed. When he heard voices outside his door, he sensed the barrage of their uneasiness, the curdling plans of violence behind the forefront of their minds. He had no way to defend himself. Despairing, Kip slid his head against the cool metal wall of the door, trying to pick out a few select words of the conversation. "Scheduled for execution this afternoon. Know that. We are, take him. Admiral, authorization right here. Irregular. Why, want him. Weapons test, target, new concept, vital to the fleet's new armaments, right away. Need specific, only a general authorization. No, good enough." The voices rose, but Kip couldn't make out more of the words. He tried to decipher three voices talking all at once. Kip made ready to lash out the moment the door slid open. He knew he would be cut down by blaster fire in no time, but at least it would be over, and he would be shot on his own terms, not the Empire's. "Check with, first. Wait." Suddenly Kip heard a thump and a muffled blast. A heavy object smashed against the doorway. Kip flinched back as the door whisked open. The dead stormtrooper guard sprawled backward into his cell with a clatter of white armor. A smoking hole oozed steam from the waist joint in the brittle uniform. Another stormtrooper stepped inside holding the still-warm blaster pistol. Beside him stood a willowy alien woman, looking delicate but outraged at the same time. "I hope that was sufficient authorization," the stormtrooper said, then pulled off his helmet. "Han!" Kip cried. "I really hate red tape," Han said, nudging the dead guard with his foot. "Think you can fit into that uniform, kid?" "No, I don't want one of the slow old ones." Qui snapped at the keeper of the Wookiee work detail. Through the narrowed field of view in his stormtrooper helmet, Han watched the delicate woman play the part of a tough, impatient researcher. The rotund man glanced at his hairy charges, unintimidated as if he were accustomed to being shouted at by prima donna scientists. The keeper's face looked like pale, wet clay. Han fidgeted, sweating in the cramped uniform. The helmet had nose filters, but the suit still smelled of body odor from its former owner. The stormtroopers at Maw installation lived in their uniforms and likely disinfected the interiors much less often than they polished the exteriors. The keeper shrugged, as if Kui's impatience did not concern him. These Wookiees have been worked hard for over a decade. What do you expect from them? They're all slow and worthless. Han could see that most of the other Wookiees wandering around the hangar bay had patchy fur and stooped shoulders, bringing them almost to the height of a human. These slaves looked as if they will have been crushed over years of harsh servitude. I don't want to hear your excuses, Kui said. She tossed her head, making the feathery pearls of her hair shimmer. We've been ordered to get a lot of work done before the fleet departs, and I need a Wookiee with some energy. Give me that new prisoner you have. He'll do the work. Not a good idea, the keeper said, wrinkling his pasty forehead. He's unruly, and you'd have to double-check his work. Can't trust him not to try sabotage. I don't care how unruly he can get. Kui snapped. At least he won't fall asleep on the job. On the far side of the bay, a tall Wookiee stepped out of a Gamma-class assault shuttle. He straightened from the cramped quarters and looked around the bay. Han had to force himself not to yank off his helmet and call out Chewbacca's name. The Wookiee seemed ready to strike, barely restraining himself from flying into a suicidal rage. With his bare hands, Chewbacca could dismantle 5 or 6 TIE fighters before the stormtroopers took him down. The keeper glanced at Chewbacca, as if considering. I have authorization from Admiral Dalla herself, Kui said, holding out a curled hardcopy bearing Dalla's seal. Han glanced at the other stormtroopers standing guard in the engine pool. He could not invoke the same violent authorization he had used to spring Kip Duran from his cell. Beside Kui Zux, Kip, wearing the smaller of the two stolen stormtrooper uniforms, stood stock still. Han knew the kid must be terrified, but Kip had snapped to attention and done everything Han suggested. Han felt a rush of warmth inside, and he hoped Kip could get out of here to the normal life he deserved. All right, but you take him at your own risk, the keeper finally said. I won't be responsible if he ruins whatever you have him working on. He whistled and motioned for a pair of stormtroopers to bring Chewbacca over. The Wookiee growled in anger, glaring around with hard, dark eyes. He did not recognize Han, nor did he know Kui Zux. Chewbacca glared at them, resenting another assignment. A little more cooperation, the keeper yelled, then struck out with his energy lash, burning a smoking welt across Chewbacca's shoulder blades. The Wookiee howled and snarled but somehow restrained himself as the other stormtroopers hauled out their blasters, ready to stun him if he went wild. Han tensed, clenching his fists as much as the armored gloves would allow. More than anything, he wanted to shove the generating handle of the energy lash down the keeper's throat and switch it on full power. But instead Han stood at attention, doing nothing, saying nothing. Like a good stormtrooper. The four of them marched out of the hangar bay. The keeper ignored them as he strode to the other captive Wookiees and began to strike left and right with his energy lash, venting his anger. Han felt his stomach knotting. Chewbacca kept looking from side to side, as if searching for his chance to escape. Han just hoped they could get someplace private before the big Wookiee decided to tear them all apart. The doors closed, leaving them in a harshly lit white corridor. Chewie! Han said, pulling off his stormtrooper helmet. After breathing through the sour nose filters, even the musky scent of a Wookiee smelled sweet to him. Chewbacca bleated in delighted surprise and grabbed Han in a huge hug, wrapping hairy arms around him and lifting him off the floor. Han gasped for breath, grateful for the protection of the armor. Put me down, he said, trying to stop himself from chuckling. If somebody sees you, they'll think you're killing me. Wouldn't that be a stupid reason to get blasted? Chewbacca agreed and lowered him back to the floor. Now what? Han asked Qui. If you can pilot us out of here, we can escape, Qui said. Han grinned. If that's our only problem, we're home free. I can pilot any ship, just give me the chance. Then let's get out of here, she said. Time is running out. When they boarded the shuttle back down to Maw installation, Han could ask no further questions. Surrounded by other stormtroopers rigidly minding their own business, neither he nor Kip could speak with Qui. Casual conversation seemed forbidden. Qui fidgeted, looking at the shuttle walls, the narrow windows showing the deadly barrier of the Maw itself with its secret pathways, if they could escape. Han desperately wanted to see Leia and the twins again. They filled his thoughts more and more, preoccupying him at times when he should have fixed every iota of attention on the peril around him. He ached to hold Leia again, but thinking of her while he wore a stormtrooper uniform seemed to taint the emotion. Beside him sat Kip, unreadable behind a stormtrooper mask. But the eye holes of the helmet continued to turn toward Han, as if seeking reassurance. Han wished he had more to offer, but he did not know Qui's plan. Why were they returning to Maw installation, rather than just stealing a ship and racing off into space? It would be a breakneck run, no matter when they started, and Admiral Dalla's attack preparations grew more complete with each hour. Han had to warn the New Republic of the disaster about to befall it. First, he had been concerned about the concentration of space power around Kessel, but the fleet of four Star Destroyers and the Maw installation's secret weapons looked infinitely worse than whatever Morath Duel had pieced together from the scrap heap. Chewbacca wore mechanics overalls, looking like a worker assigned to perform maintenance on some piece of equipment down in one of the laboratories. He made grunting sounds to himself, content to be reunited with his friends but anxious for action. Qui remained uncommunicative, keeping her thin bluish hands folded in her lap. Han wondered if he had gone too far in his accusations of her naivete and the evil nature of her work. He wished he knew what she was thinking. When the shuttle landed in one of the installation's asteroids and the stormtroopers disembarked, Qui led Han, Kip, and Chewbacca away from the rocky hangar through a tunnel high enough to allow the movement of ships. This way, she said. Han did not recognize where she was taking them. Aren't we going back to your lab, Doc? Qui froze in mid-step before turning to him. No, never again. Then she moved on. When they reached a tall metal doorway guarded by two stormtroopers standing at attention, Qui took out her badge again, flashing the imprinted holograms in the light. The stormtroopers straightened to attention. Open up for me, Qui said. Yes, Dr. Zux, the head guard said. Your badge, please. She handed him her badge with a barely controlled smile. Han began to grow uneasy. These guards recognized Qui by sight, and she seemed more comfortable now than she had been during other parts of their escape. Was this some kind of treachery? But to what purpose? He and Kip turned toward each other, but the stormtrooper helmets kept their expressions unreadable. The Wookiee is here to do heavy maintenance on the engines, a complete coolant overhaul before tomorrow's deployment of the fleet, Qui said. These two guards are specially trained to prevent him from acting up. This Wookiee has caused some damage before, and we can't afford delays. Han tried not to cringe. Qui was talking too quickly, letting her nervousness show through. Just give me the proper authorizations, the guard said. You know the routine. He slid her badge through a scanner to log Qui in, then handed it back to her. The stormtrooper seemed unconcerned, as if glad to be posted here rather than in the middle of frantic preparations for deployment. Qui went to the door's data terminal and punched up a request, then she handed him the hard copy printout of Admiral Dalla's permission again. Han wondered how many times she was going to use the same piece of paper. There, you'll see the approved work request for the Wookiee with a notation for special handlers. It's been authorized by Tol Sivrin himself. The guard shrugged. As usual. Let me scan the service numbers of these two troopers. Then you're free to go in. He entered Han's and Kip's numbers, then worked the door controls. The great steel-crete doors ground to each side, revealing a hangar lit by levitating globes of light. Overhead, wide rectangular skylights let in the eerie glow of swirling gases around the mall. Qui stepped inside the chamber, and her whole demeanor changed, as if she had suddenly turned breathless. Han, Kip, and Chewbacca followed. The guard worked his controls, and the doors slid closed, sealing them inside. Qui visibly relaxed. Han stared up at a ship like none he had ever seen before. Smaller than the Millennium Falcon, this craft was oblong and faceted, like a long shard of crystal. Its own repulsor lifts kept it upright, with an actual ladder leading to the open hatch. Defensive lasers bristled from the corners of its facets. The armor plating was multicolored and shimmering, like a constantly changing pool of oil and molten metal. At the lower vertex hung the oddly fuzzy torus of an immensely powerful resonance torpedo transmitter. Though not much larger than a fighter craft, the Suncrusher hummed with deadly potential. "We're going to steal that," Han cried. "Of course," Quizuk said. "It's the greatest weapon ever devised, and I've spent 8 years of my life designing it. You didn't expect me to leave it here for Admiral Dalla, did you?" Chapter 26. The Millennium Falcon subspace engines flared white hot, as the ship blasted away from Kessel's garrison moon. A swarm of fighters streamed after it, peppering space with multicolored blaster fire. Large capital ships began to nose into the Falcon's flight path like sleeping giants roused by stinging insects. Lando Calrissian did his best to dodge the concentrated blaster fire. "The sublight engines are still optimal. Either Han's been maintaining her with a real mechanic for a change, or Duel reconditioned her for his fleet," he said. "Let's see how well the weapon systems work." A pair of Wasp-like Z-95 headhunters streaked after them, shooting fire-length banks of triple blasters. Close behind followed three battered Y-wing long-range fighters. Luke spun around and whistled in surprise. "Headhunters. I didn't think anybody used those anymore." "Duel couldn't be choosy, I guess," Lando said. The Falcon rocked with several direct blaster hits, the fresh and fully charged shields held, though, for the moment. Lando dropped the blaster cannon through its ventral hatch, then fired back at the pursuers. After five prolonged shots, Lando managed to hit the exhaust nacelle of a Y-wing, forcing it to break formation and peel off for repairs. "One down, only about 1,000 more to go," Lando said. The Z-95 headhunters pummeled them with repeated blaster fire, as if to punish the Falcon. "Go down close to the planet and skim the atmosphere," Luke said. "Let's burn them up in the energy shield." Lando set course for the lumpy world of Kessel as he voiced his complaints. "We can't detect that energy shield either. How do you know we won't get disintegrated ourselves? We've got better reactions than they do." Lando didn't seem convinced. "I've already almost flown into an energy shield once during our attack on the Death Star. I'm not anxious to repeat the process." "Trust me," Luke said. Kessel swelled in front of them, pockmarked and wreathed in a cottony halo of escaping air. "We're getting close." Luke held the back of the pilot chair, his eyes half closed. He breathed regularly, reaching out, sensing the pulsing power generated as a protective blanket by the garrison moon. "Don't fall asleep on me, Luke. Keep flying." The headhunters swooped after, flanked by the remaining pair of Y-wings. "The aft deflector shield is starting to feel the pounding," Lando said. "If these guys get any closer, they're going to fly up my exhaust ports." "Get ready," Luke said. Kessel filled their entire viewport now, boiling with its turbulent thin air storms, tiny plumes from the numerous atmosphere factories tracing lines above the landscape. "I'm ready, I'm ready. Just say the word and I pull up, now." Lando's tension helped him react like a spring-loaded catapult. He hauled up on the controls, ripping the Falcon straight up in a tight cartwheel. Taken by surprise, all four of the attacking ships splattered into clouds of ignited fuel and ionized metal as they slammed into the invisible energy shield. "Missed it by a couple of meters at least," Luke said. "Relax, Lando." R2 bleeped, and Luke answered him after looking at the expression on Lando's face. "No, R2, I don't think he's interested in an exact measurement." They soared just above the atmosphere on a tight orbit that took them around Kessel's poles. The curtain of stars rolled out from the edge of the planet as the landscape sped beneath them, then they looped back into space in a mad dash to escape. They ran straight into the wave of fighters belching out of the garrison moon. Yelling in surprise, Lando launched a pair of arcade concussion missiles from the front tubes. The density of approaching ships was so great that even the wild shots scored twice, taking out a TIE fighter and a blast boat, while the hot debris cloud destroyed a heavily armed B-wing. "Let's not get cocky because we took care of a couple of ships. I've got only 6 more missiles." "We will not surrender now," Luke said. "No, I just mean we're running, not fighting. At least the engines are in tip-top condition," Lando said. "The Falcon hasn't been this pampered since I owned her. How fast can we get out of here?" Luke asked. Jacked next to the co-pilot's chair, R2 chittered and bleeped. Luke glanced down and saw rows of flickering red lights on the navigation panel. "Oh. What is he saying?" Lando said. He flicked his gaze from the ship swarming by the front viewport to the little astromech droid. "What's wrong with him?" "The navicomp's not working," Luke said. "Well, fix it." Luke had already dashed around the bend in the corridor to pry off the access panel to the Falcon's navicomputer. He glanced at the boards, feeling his heart sink into a black hole as deep as the maw. "They've pulled the coordinate module. It's not here." Lando groaned. "Now what are we going to do?" In response to Lando's concussion missiles, the Kessel fighters formed into tighter battle groups, striking at the Falcon with a firestorm of blaster bolts. Luke had to shield his eyes from the blinding flashes of near misses and deflected hits. "I don't know, but we'd better do it as fast as we can." They're from the New Republic. Morath Duel fumed in his rage, stomping up and down. "They'll go back and report everything." He straightened his must-yellow cravat to regain his composure, but it didn't work. He wanted to squash the escapees like a pair of bugs to eat. Spies and traitors. They had led him along, lied to him, taunted him. "Send out every ship we have," he screamed into the open channel that broadcast to his forces. He had managed to make it to the command center on the garrison moon. "Surround them, crush them, smash into them. I don't care what it takes." "Sending out every ship might not be a good strategy," responded one of the captains. "The pilots don't know the formations, and they'll just get in each other's way." Duel's mechanical eye lay in pieces scattered about the top of the console, and he could not see well enough to put it back together. With the blurry focus of his one half-blind eye, Duel could not identify the dissenting mercenary. "I don't care. I don't want to lose these like we lost Han Solo." He pounded his soft fist on the console, jarring the pieces of his mechanical eye. The primary lens bounced, then slid off the edge to shatter on the floor. The Falcon ran straight toward the maw, leaving Kessel behind. "We'll be all right," Luke said. "I can use the Force to guide us through on a safe path." "If there is a safe path," Lando muttered. Sweat stood out on Luke's forehead. "What other choice do we have? We can't hide anyplace else, we can't outrun all those fighters, and we can't go into hyperspace without a navicomp." "What a great selection of options," Lando said. Finally mobilized, the capital ships came after them, firing ion cannon blasts powerful enough to clear a path through an asteroid field. The two big Lancer frigates made a deadly web in front of the Falcon with their 20 quad-firing laser cannons, but the Lancers were sluggish, and the Falcon increased its lead. Somehow the other capital ships anticipated their run to the black hole cluster and converged ahead of them as Lando pushed the Falcon's engines.
Come on, come on. Just squeeze a little more speed out.
10 system patrol craft, originally designed for maximum speed to combat smugglers and pirates, surged past the Falcon and lined up in a blockade. But in the three-dimensional vastness of space, Lando managed to slip under their grasp. Laser blasts erupted all around them.
Our shields are edging the red lines, Lando said.
3 Kara-class light cruisers, midway in size between the Lancer frigates and the larger dreadnoughts such as the ones in Bel Iblis's Lost Dark Force, formed a triple-pronged pincer, right, left, and top. In hot pursuit behind the Falcon came the jagged ovoid of a Lorner strike cruiser, the largest ship in the Kessel fleet. As the chase plowed through the net of system patrol craft, the strike cruiser harmlessly took stray fire meant for the Falcon. Lando stared out the viewport windows at the horrifying spectacle of the Maw and the giant battleships moving to meet them.
R2 bleeped something that even Luke could not translate.
Only a complete idiot would go into a place like that, Lando said.
He squeezed his eyes shut.
Then let's just hope they're not idiots too, Luke said. Chapter 27 Admiral Dalla stood in the bridge tower of the Star Destroyer Gorgon, looking out at her fleet and feeling the energy build inside her. The time was at hand. The Empire might have fallen, but with it went all the people who had squashed her. Now she could show her worth. Dalla could fight her own battle. She gazed at the misty colors of the Maw and the clump of strung-together rocks that had spawned the weapons for her assault. In formation the Hydra, the Basilisk, and the Manticore powered up, waiting to spring out upon the galaxy with swift and deadly precision. The New Republic would fall to its knees. She had no interest in ruling the former empire herself, Dalla never had any such aspirations. Her main intent right now was just to cause them pain. She licked her lips, and her hair hung heavy down her back, serpentine like the demon for whom her flagship had been named. Grand Moff Tarkin would have been proud. Commander Kratos, the man who ran the subsystems of the Gorgon, spoke to her from a communication terminal.
Admiral Dalla, I have a priority message from the detention level.
Detention level?
What is it?
The prisoners Han Solo and Kip Duran have escaped.
One guard was found stunned in Solo's detention chamber, and another is dead in Duran's cell.
Both were stripped of their armor.
We are attempting to question the survivor now.
Dalla felt a jolt of anger disrupt the eagerness singing through her veins.
She drew herself up taller, raising her eyebrows and focusing intently on Kratos.
Track the service numbers of the stolen uniforms.
Maybe they've logged in somewhere.
Her orders came like staccato laser blasts.
Kratos consulted his terminal, spoke into the comlink.
Dalla clasped her hands behind her back and paced, barking orders to the bridge personnel.
Put together a search party immediately.
We'll comb every deck of the Gorgon.
They can't have gotten off the ship.
There's no place else they could have gone.
Admiral.
Commander Kratos said.
The surviving guard claims that one of the scientists from the installation came to see Solo.
Qui Zux.
The guard insists that Dr. Zux had an authorization directly from you.
Dalla's jaw dropped, then she clamped her lips together in a bloodless, iron line.
Check on the Wookiee.
See what's happened to him.
Kratos queried the database.
The keeper says that the new Wookiee prisoner has been requisitioned and taken to a higher priority assignment.
He swallowed.
Qui Zux was the one who requisitioned him.
She used your authorization code again.
Dalla's nostrils flared, but then another thought struck her like a crashing asteroid.
Oh no, she said.
They're after the Suncrusher.
Alone in the guarded hangar holding the Suncrusher, Han clambered into the hatch.
Can't remember the last time I had to use a ladder to get inside a ship.
Pretty primitive for such a sophisticated weapon.
It works.
Qui hauled herself up the rungs behind him. The sophistication is inside. All the rest is just window dressing. Han sat down in the pilot's chair in the cockpit and looked at the controls. Everything seems to be labeled the way it should be, though the placement is a little odd. What's this for? Wait a minute, I'll figure it out. Kip reached the top of the ladder, paused, then pulled off his stormtrooper helmet. Those mask filters stink, he said, then with obvious pleasure tossed the skull-like helmet to the floor of the chamber. It clattered and bounced like a severed head. Kip's dark hair was curled with sweat and must from the confining helmet, but his face shone with a grin. Chewbacca swung into the compartment, ducking his head and squeezing through the narrow hatch. He looked at the skylights in the chamber's ceiling, then growled at the shape of a Star Destroyer orbiting overhead. Han dropped his own helmet to the floor of the cockpit. Kip kicked it under the seat and out of the way. Han touched the Suncrusher's Navicomp, switching it on. This thing is in better shape than the Imperial shuttle we stole. Are all the coordinates burned into the database, Doc? Qui nodded, sitting down primly and strapping herself into her seat. The Suncrusher has been ready to go for years. We've just been waiting for orders from the Empire. Good thing nobody came back, right? Han pursed his lips, scanning the controls. Everything here looks pretty standard, he said. I won't have much time for practice. Chewbacca gave an ear-splitting Wookiee bellow of challenge. Below, Han heard the heavy armored door grind open and then clattering footsteps as a squad of stormtroopers charged into the chamber. Standing at the door, Kip stuck his head out of the narrow hatch. Here they come. Seal that hatch, kid, Han shouted. We're in here for the duration now. Chewie, have you found the weapons controls yet? In the co-pilot's chair, Chewbacca ran his huge hands over the buttons and dials. Finally finding what he wanted, he let out a yowl. Defensive laser cannons mounted at different targeting angles swiveled as he tested the aiming mechanisms. Small thuds banged against the Suncrusher's hull as the stormtroopers fired their blaster rifles, causing no damage. Han looked at Qui. We don't even have the shields on. This armor will hold against anything they can throw against us, she said with a smug smile. It was designed to. Han grinned and cracked his knuckles. Well, in that case let's take an extra few seconds and do this right. He worked the controls, activating the repulsor lift engines. The interior of the Suncrusher wobbled as the entire craft rose into the air, floating on its repulsor cushion. Outside they could hear the faint screeching of an alarm. Chewie, point those laser cannons straight up. Let's give ourselves a 21-gun salute, right through the roof. The Wookiee roared to himself, then, without waiting for Han to give the order, he fired all of the Suncrusher's weaponry at once. Kip scrambled for his seat, strapping himself in. Qui stared at the roof of the cockpit with wide eyes. The ceiling of the hangar chamber blasted outward under the barrage of laser energy. Some of the larger chunks of rubble fell downward, clanging against the Suncrusher's hull, but most of the skylights burst into space with the outrushing of contained air that spewed into the maw. Stormtroopers, flailing their arms and legs, were sucked out through the breach, flotsam among the rock and transparasteel debris in low orbit around the clustered rocks. Their armor might protect them against massive decompression for a few minutes, but every one of them was doomed. Han raised the Suncrusher up, accelerating through the escape hole they had blown through the top of the chamber. They shot into open space, and Han felt an exhilaration he had not felt since they had first arrived at Kessel. Here goes nothing, he said. Now for the fun part. Staring down at the installation from the Gorgon's Bridge, Admiral Dalla felt her stomach knot. For years her entire duty had been to protect that small clump of planetoids, to pamper the scientists. Grand Moff Tarkin had said these people held the future security of the Empire, and she had believed him. Dalla had been stepped on, abused, taken advantage of at the Carradine Military Academy. Tarkin had rescued her from that. He had given her the responsibility and the power she had earned through her own abilities.
She owed Tarkin everything. She would avenge him by destroying the New Republic as she caused their star systems to go supernova one by one. They could hide nowhere. At the same time, she would make her mark on the history of the galaxy, a warlord who had succeeded where an entire empire had failed. The thought made Dalla's pale lips curl upward in a grim smile. As she watched, Dalla saw the puff of an explosion on one of the rocks of Maw installation. Then the tiny form of the Suncrusher streaked by, a characteristically angular speck fleeing the confines of the planetoid containing it. "Red alert," she shouted. "Mobilize all forces. They have the Suncrusher, and we can't let them take it away. That is our most valuable weapon." "But, Admiral," Commander Kratos said, "if the technical reports are correct, nothing can harm the Suncrusher. We must find some way to capture them. Mobilize the other Star Destroyers. We'll try to blockade them, cut off their escape. Release enough small fighters to overwhelm them." She fixed Kratos with her gaze. Her hair seemed to rise by itself, as if threatening to become a garrote for his throat. "Make certain you understand this, Commander. I don't care how many losses we take, we cannot forfeit the Suncrusher. That one weapon is worth more to me than all 6 TIE fighter squadrons on board this Star Destroyer. Retrieve it at all costs." 3 Star Destroyers closed in behind the stolen Suncrusher. "Didn't take them long to figure something was up," Han said. Clouds of TIE fighters spewed out of the launching bays of the Manticore and the Gorgon, swarming toward them in formations so dense that Han could not see through them. Flashing, splattering laser bolts struck like pelting raindrops on the viewscreen. "I always wanted to see if I could fly blindfolded," Han said. "What are they doing? Trying to smother us or just confuse us?" Kui said. The Suncrusher, undamaged, rocked left and right from the pummeling of blaster strikes. "No, but they can wipe out our external weaponry. In fact, they already have," Han said, checking the readouts. "Every one of our lasers is offline." "We just have to outrun them then," Kip said. Another Star Destroyer, the Basilisk, unleashed its squadrons of TIE fighters in wave after wave out of the launching bay. "Those ships are going to clog space so we can't even move." Han wrenched the Suncrusher's controls, trying to dodge but just squeezing his eyes shut most of the time. "Whoever heard of a traffic jam in the middle of a black hole cluster?" Kip grabbed his shoulder. "Watch out, Han." The 4th and last Star Destroyer reared up between them and the outside universe, blocking their passage. The Hydra lanced out with its enormous turbolaser cannons, aiming concentrated firepower at the single small ship. The remaining 3 Star Destroyers pressed in from behind to cut off their escape through the maze of the black hole cluster. "Now what?" Kip asked. The great arrowhead shape of the Hydra filled space in front of them. "Kui, you said this armor could take anything, didn't you?" Han asked. "Everything I could test it with." "All right, hold on. Time to accelerate for whatever this fancy toy is worth." He jammed the control levers back. The sudden force shoved the 4 escapees back into their seats as the Suncrusher surged forward, straight toward the Hydra. The huge battleship grew larger and larger, filling their entire field of view, and still expanding. Great green turbolaser bolts shot out at them, but the cannons could not refocus their aim points fast enough to compensate for the ship streaking directly at them. "Han, what are you doing?" Kip cried. "Trust me," Han said. "Or actually, trust her." He nodded toward Kui. "If she messed up her test measurements, we're all going to be one big organic pancake." The Hydra's trapezoidal bridge tower rushed toward them, directly in their path. One suicidal TIE fighter rammed into the Suncrusher to deflect its course, but merely exploded upon hitting the invincible quantum armor. Han had no trouble compensating for the error in trajectory. "Look out!" Kui yelled. Details of the bridge tower filled their view now as they screamed toward the Imperial battleship. Han could actually see the windows of the bridge, the tiny figures of the command crew, some of them paralyzed in horror, others fleeing madly.
Han!
Qui and Kip screamed in unison. Chewbacca gave a wordless roar.
Right down their throat.
Han said. The armored suncrusher tore through the Hydra's control bridge like a bullet. Flying debris sprayed in their wake. The ship shot out the other side, shredding the superstructure on its way out. The impact, the inferno, and a sound like a thousand gongs knocked them into a temporary stupor.
Han finally hooped.
We made it. Behind them the great battleship erupted in flames.
You're crazy.
Qui said.
Don't thank me yet, Doc, Han said.
Burning, out of control, the decapitated Hydra wheeled backward, drifting helplessly toward the gravitational trap of one of the black holes. A flurry of escape pods shot out of the crew decks, but the low-power lifeboat engines could not generate sufficient acceleration to take them free of the black holes, and their trajectories began to spiral in. The lower decks and the immense hyperdrive engines of the doomed Star Destroyer began to explode as it toppled into the unstable trap of the Maw Cluster. Clouds of belching flames stretched out and elongated, mingling with the swirling gas as the Hydra began its infinite plunge into the singularity.
We're not home free by a long shot, Han said as he soared into the soup of ionized gas.
Okay, Kip, he said. Now it's your turn to take the controls.
Get us out of here.
Moments later the other three Star Destroyers rallied behind them, in howling pursuit. Chapter 28. On the Gorgon's Bridge, Admiral Dalla watched in horror as the Hydra crumpled into destruction, its command bridge blown apart from the impact of the Suncrusher. The battleship's only survivors would be the fighters in the six TIE squadrons, otherwise, all hands would be lost. Though her expression was carved in ice, hot tears burned unshed in Dalla's eyes. Thousands of people crashed to their deaths as the Hydra fell like a great slain dragon into the black whirlpool. Glinting with its maddening invincibility, the Suncrusher streaked through the wreckage, arrowing for the outer wall of the Maw.
After them.
Dalla snapped.
Full pursuit.
Failure crashed down on her like an anvil. She had been hiding in the Maw for too long, drilling her troops, putting them through practice exercises and dress rehearsals, but that had not been enough. In her first actual battle Dalla had lost a quarter of her command, against four escaped prisoners. Grand Moff Tarkin would have struck her sharply across the face and relieved her of her rank. Dalla's cheeks stung with the imaginary blow.
They will regret the day they ever unleashed us, she whispered.
But without the Suncrusher, her plans to spread havoc among the New Republic would fall apart. She took a deep, sharp breath.
No time to panic now.
Think fast.
Make decisions.
Salvage the situation. The communications dais shimmered, and an image of Tol Sivrin appeared. The transmission flickered with staticky disruptions caused by the laser blasts flashing around them.
Admiral Dalla.
If you intend to deploy your fleet, I insist that you take the scientists of Maw installation with you. Not bothering to turn and look at the image of the Twi'lek, Dalla continued to watch the Hydra's fiery death. She thought of all the run-ins she'd had with the administrator, Sivrin's incompetence, his delays, his excuses, his insistence on reports and tests ad nauseam.
You're on your own, Tol Sivrin.
It is time we do our duty as Imperial soldiers.
Tol Sivrin flicked his head tail straight out behind him in agitation.
Are you just going to leave us undefended? What about the orders Grand Moff Tarkin gave you?
You are supposed to protect us.
At least leave one of your Star Destroyers behind.
Dalla shook her head, making coppery hair stream around her.
Tarkin is dead, and I'm making all the decisions now. I need every ounce of firepower to deal a fatal blow to the New Republic.
Admiral Dalla, I must insist.
Dalla yanked out the blaster pistol at her hip and pointed it at Sivrin's image on the communications dais. If the Twi'lek had been on the bridge in person, she would have killed him, but she would not destroy valuable equipment in a fit of anger. Keeping the blaster pointed directly into Tol Sivan's image, as if to threaten him, she strode forward.
"Request denied, Director Sivran," Dala said, then disconnected the dais. She turned back to watch her fleet, undisturbed.
"Commander Kratos, we are going to leave the Maw in pursuit of the Suncrusher. Recall all TIE fighter squadrons, now."
Kratos gave the order, and she watched as the tiny ships streamed back toward their bays.
Dala fidgeted, hating the delay.
"Have all three Star Destroyers link into the same course computer. I will call up the specific coordinates from my own personal records, coded to my password."
The last time anyone had left Maw installation, it had been the construction engineers, and they had been given the wrong course, dooming them to fall into one of the black holes. This time, though, Admiral Dala and all the firepower at her disposal would spring out upon the unwary galaxy, ready to take it back.
The Suncrusher vibrated from a thousand stresses, as it rode the razor's edge of gravity through the maelstrom of the Maw. Kip Duran sat at the simplified controls, next to the watchful eyes of Han Solo, but Han didn't dream of interfering with Kip's intuition, no matter how nightmarish the path ahead seemed. Kip half closed his eyes as he looked through a mental vision of the perilous maze to safety. He jerked the ship to starboard, then plunged down, frantically avoiding unseen obstacles. Han kept a firm, reassuring pressure on the kid's shoulder. Hot gas blazed around them like hell's furnace. Kwee-Zux stared at Kip and his blind piloting, her dark blue eyes wide and her face transfixed with terror.
"Don't worry," Han said. "The kid knows what he's doing. He'll get us through, if anybody can."
"But how is he doing it?" Kwee's voice sounded fluty, like high-pitched notes played by an amateur performer.
"Not in any way your science can explain. I'm not sure I understand the Force myself, but I don't question it. I used to think it was a hokey religion, but not anymore."
Abruptly the curtains of gas parted in front of them, peeling away to reveal the black infinity of open space. At last they were free of the Maw. In their mad run away from the forces of Kessel, Luke and Lando tried to push through the clustered capital ships. They winced simultaneously every time a bolt impacted the Falcon's shields. The mammoth form of the Loraner strike cruiser lay directly across their path, cutting them off from a dubious escape into the Maw. The 10 ion cannons mounted in front of the strike cruiser belched destruction at them. One bolt struck the Millennium Falcon dead on, and their systems flickered as sparks flew out of the control panels. Lando grabbed at the overrides and yelled to Luke, "Our shields are failing, and these guys don't want to take prisoners."
"Just get us into the Maw," Luke said. "It's our only chance."
"I never thought I'd be keeping my fingers crossed for that to happen."
Lando hunched over the controls.
"R2, see if you can pump up the front shields. We're going to take quite a pounding from that strike cruiser when we pass by. One good hit and we're fried."
"Wait," Luke said, squinting at the swirling gases ahead of them.
"Something's coming out." The thorn-like form of the Suncrusher streaked away from the cluster, leaving a trail of hot gases. A few moments later, three fully armed Imperial-class Star Destroyers charged out of the Maw like banthas on fire. Han's sigh of relief turned into an exclamation of dismay, as he saw the array of Kessel's battle fleet massed in front of them, weapons already blazing.
"Where did all those ships come from? They can't still be waiting for us."
Exhausted from his piloting ordeal, Kip said, "Han, why is it that every time we escape, we end up in a worse situation than the one we left?"
"Just good timing, kid."
He slammed his fist down on the armored controls.
"This isn't fair. They should have given us up for dead days ago."
Chewbacca yowled and jabbed his hairy finger at the viewport, pointing to a ship at the vanguard of the gathered attack forces.
"The Millennium Falcon."
Han's lip curled downward. "I'm going to get that slime merchant who's flying my ship. Don't we have any of our laser cannons still operational?"
After rechecking the banks of instruments, Chewbacca granted a negative. Then we'll ram them like we did that Star Destroyer.
Han, Kip said, it looks to me like those other ships are chasing the Falcon.
They're shooting at it.
Han leaned forward to take a closer look.
Qui agreed with Kip's assessment.
That light freighter doesn't appear to be part of the attacking fleet.
Green turbolaser bolts streaked toward the Falcon from the system patrol craft, the big strike cruiser, and the Kara-class light cruisers.
Han's expression changed immediately.
Hey, what's going on here?
They better not blow up my ship.
Then Dala's Star Destroyers emerged behind them, plowing their way out of the clutches of the Maw.
Look on the rear screens, Han.
Kip said.
The Star Destroyers Gorgon, Basilisk, and Manticore burst out like monsters leaping from a closet, giant demons loaded with destructive weaponry from the fallen empire.
The pell-mell mercenary forces of Kessel, already firing their laser cannons at the Falcon, ran headlong into the Imperial fleet.
Some peeled sideways, turning to flee back toward the sanctuary of Kessel.
Others panicked and opened fire on the Star Destroyers.
Admiral Dala tried to control the actions of her entire fleet from a single station on the bridge.
Encountering the strange warships on the other side of the Maw shocked her, but she reacted quickly.
Shields up.
This was a trap.
The rebels had their forces here waiting.
How had Han Solo deceived her interrogation droid?
Had the rebels somehow found out about the installation and sent Solo inside with a cooked-up story to lure Dala's fleet out where they could be destroyed?
She saw the enemy fleet opening fire on her ships, but they were no match for her firepower.
After all, Grand Moff Tarkin had given her enough weaponry to slag whole planets.
Battle stations. Let's mop up this rabble once and for all.
She pointed to the conglomeration of fighters swarming across her path.
Open fire.
Luke and Lando spared a moment to glance at each other, as the crossfire erupted around them.
This could be our chance to get out of here.
Lando said.
Yeah, they might not even notice us leaving, Luke said.
But where in the universe did those Star Destroyers come from?
Suddenly a beep sounded from the Falcon's comm channels, distinctive because it sounded so innocent amid the warning tones of overloading systems and failing shields.
R2 whistled, calling attention to it.
Lando looked down.
We're getting a message over the Falcon's private comm frequency.
Lando frowned.
How would anybody know to transmit that?
How would anybody even know the Falcon's private code?
Then Han Solo's angry voice burst over the speaker.
Whoever is on the Falcon better have a damned good reason for flying my ship.
Han.
Is that you?
Lando said.
A sudden thrill surged through Luke.
Lando?
Han said after a pause.
Over the speakers, Chewbacca's roar drowned out Han's own exclamation.
What are you doing here?
In space around them, blinding lances of light flashed as the weapons of two fleets were brought to bear.
Like rival crate dragons in mating season, the Kessel and Imperial forces slammed into each other in a total free-for-all space brawl.
Han, listen to me.
Luke is here, too, Lando said.
We've got to get away from Kessel, but the Falcon's navicomputer is disabled.
We can't make the jump into hyperspace.
An explosion rocked them from the starboard side, but most of the Kessel fighters concentrated their firepower on the much larger threat of Dala's Imperial fleet.
Though hopelessly outmatched, the three Kara cruisers lined up and began to blast the Basilisk.
Over the private comm channel Han spoke to someone else behind him, then answered Lando.
We can dump the coordinates to your Navicomp, and we'll fly tandem back to Coruscant.
Lando checked the computer, saw the numbers scrolling through, and raised a fist in triumph.
Got it.
R2, get ready to go.
You'd better keep my ship safe, Lando, Han said.
On my signal.
You have my word, Han.
Lando's hands flew over the Falcon's familiar controls.
Ready to enter hyperspace.
Han said.
The Kessel forces flanked and attacked the far larger Star Destroyers, pummeling the Imperial ships with blasts from their ion cannons and turbolaser banks. But the Star Destroyers disgorged their own squadrons of TIE fighters to butcher the unregimented forces from Kessel.
On your mark, Han. Punch it.
The last thing they saw was Kessel's massive Lorner strike cruiser exploding under the concerted fire from the Manticore and the Gorgon. They watched the flaming Hulk reel and ram into the Star Destroyer Basilisk, causing the bottom of the Arrowhead hull to buckle and burn. Then, the universe filled with star lines. Chapter 29. The reunion was everything Han had imagined. He had spent a lot of time thinking about it during the long hyperspace flight back to Coruscant. Leia and the twins met him the moment the Suncrusher and the Millennium Falcon touched down side by side at the high landing platform. Han backed out of the Suncrusher's hatch and began climbing down the ladder, but Leia ran forward and hugged him before he managed to get all the way down.
"Glad I'm back," he asked.
"I missed you," she said, kissing him.
"I know," he said with a roguish smile.
She put her hands on her hips.
"What?
You didn't miss me?"
Han turned away sheepishly.
"Well, first we crashed on Kessel, then we were stuck in the spice mines, then we got captured by a bunch of Imperials in the middle of a black hole cluster. I really didn't have a whole lot of—" When Leia looked as if she were going to punch him, Han reacted with a grin. "But even through all that, I don't remember more than about 2 seconds when I didn't miss you with all my heart."
Leia kissed him again.
R2 trundled down the Falcon's ramp, and 3PO bustled to greet him, R2-D2.
"I'm so glad you're back.
You wouldn't believe the difficulties I've had while you were gone."
R2 bleeped something nobody bothered to translate.
Kip Duran and Kwee-Zux climbed down from the Suncrusher and stared out at the endless spires and towers of Imperial City, the metropolis of glinting transparisteel and alloy that stretched to the horizon. Above them the tiny lights of shuttles winked across the sky.
"Now that's a city," Kip said with a sigh.
Kwee looked overwhelmed. The Suncrusher would be transferred to a high-security hangar for study by the scientists of the New Republic. Kwee did not like abandoning it, but she had no choice. Han strode over to his two children, bending his knees and gathering Jason and Jaina into his arms.
"Hey, kids. Do you remember your daddy? It's been a long time, huh?"
He mussed their hair and stared down at them with the wide-eyed astonishment he always felt when seeing how much they had grown between the visits Winter arranged to the hidden planet of Anoth. Now, though, Jason and Jaina's 2 years of isolation and protection were over, and the children were home to stay, leaving only baby Anakin in need of special protection. Jason nodded, then a moment later Jaina nodded as well. Han wasn't sure he believed their answer, but he hugged them anyway.
"Well, if you don't remember me, I'll try to make it up to you from now on."
A puffed-up official, wearing the bright uniform of an off-world administrative office, finally cornered Lando in a highbrow diplomatic lounge. The official held an armored briefcase similar to the type credit investigators carried, and he had the same pinch-faced demeanor of a person being given a mission whose importance he drastically overestimated.
"Are you Lando Calrissian?" the official said.
"I have been attempting to locate you for several days.
You've made my job most difficult."
He bustled forward. Lando saw that he could not slip out the back entrance of the lounge. Beside him at the table, Han raised his eyebrows. Both of them had gone to the lounge to relax and settle down after their long debriefings by the Alliance High Command. Unfortunately, the lounge catered to bureaucrats and political functionaries, and served only cloyingly sweet drinks. Han and Lando sipped theirs slowly, trying to keep from grimacing. Lando had heard rumors about an investigator trying to track him down and had managed to avoid him thus far. He feared some debtor coming after him, or a complaint regarding the Tabana gas mining operations he had abandoned on Bespin or the hot metal mines he had recently lost on Niklon.
"Yes, you finally caught me," Lando said with a sigh.
"What do you want?" I can get the best legal representation in the galaxy here in Imperial City.
That won't be necessary, the investigator said, heaving his armored briefcase onto the table, then fiddling with the cyberlock.
I'll be glad to be rid of this.
He lifted the lid of his case, and glittering light sparkled out.
Other people in the lounge turned to gape.
The briefcase brimmed with carefully sorted packets of fire facet gems and shimmering chrysopaths.
I am from the planet Dargul, and this is the reward owed to you by the Duchess Miztel for the safe return of her beloved consort Dak.
You can have them appraised, but I am told these jewels are valued at approximately 1,000,000 credits.
Plus the briefcase, which is worth another 40.
Lando stared, hunched over the briefcase and dazzled by its contents.
1,000,000, he said.
1,000,000, plus 40 for the briefcase.
But I was only supposed to get half of the reward.
The investigator reached into his pocket.
I neglected to give you this.
It is a message wafer for you from Slish Fondine, the owner of the Blob Stables where you assisted apprehending our consort Dak.
He handed Lando a small rectangular object.
Lando turned it over in his hand, frowning, then ran his fingernail along the crease in its center.
He cracked the message wafer open, then folded the two halves back to stand it upright on their small table.
An image of the Blob Stable owner wafted up.
Greetings, Lando Calrissian. Since you are listening to this message, I will assume you've received your reward.
I'm happy to say that your suggestion of not executing the criminal Timo has proved advantageous to all concerned.
Duchess Miztel was so delighted to receive her consort back that she insisted on paying you the full reward, as well as offering to build a subsidiary blobstacle course for me in the main stadium on Umgol.
We are already hiring creative engineers to design even tougher blobstacles for the new course, which, at the Duchess Mistel's request, will be called the Dak Track.
I am forwarding these fire facet and chrysopaz gems to you and hope you will spend the reward wisely.
Why not come to Umgol and do some gambling?
I'd be happy to be your host.
As the message dissolved into wisps of light, Lando could do little more than stare open-mouthed at his fortune.
Han laughed, then gestured for the short investigator to sit down.
Join us for a drink.
In fact, here, you can have mine.
It's too sweet for me anyway.
The investigator shook his head, the hard expression remaining on his face.
No, thank you. I don't think I would enjoy that.
I'd rather get back to my work.
With that, the investigator left the lounge.
Han clapped Lando on the shoulder.
What are you going to do with all that money?
Still thinking of investing it in spice mining?
Lando came back to reality with a streak of defensiveness.
I hate to say this, but when Morath Duel showed us around, I was rather impressed by the potential there.
Spice has plenty of good uses, too, perfectly legitimate alternatives in psychological therapy, criminal investigation, communication with alien races, even artistic inspiration and entertainment.
You knew that, Han, or you wouldn't have run Spice yourself in the old days.
You've got a point, Lando.
But Lando's imagination kept working on the problem.
I don't see why the spice mines have to be run as some sort of slave lord operation.
A lot of that could be automated.
Even if there are more of those energy spiders running around, we could just use super-cooled droids down in the deeper tunnels.
No big investment.
I don't see what the problem is.
Han looked at him skeptically, took a gulp of his sweet drink, then puckered his lips.
Aha.
Besides, Lando said, I'm in the market for a new ship.
I had to leave the Lady Luck stranded on Kessel.
I may never get her back.
What am I supposed to do for the time being?
Seeing the eager stares from the others in the lounge, Lando snapped shut the lid of the armored briefcase.
Well, anyway, it's wonderful just to be solvent again.
Everybody in.
Wedge Antilles called, inside the echoing Imperial City spaceport.
Let's get ready to go.
The last of the New Republic colonization specialists, sociologists, and survival instructors hauled their personal packs up the ramp of the medium transport.
The 90-meter-long ship occupied the better part of an entire bay in the supply sector, but the group needed a transport large enough to haul the Eol Shah survivors and their meager possessions, as well as the supplies necessary to set up a new home on Dantooine. Wedge kept track of the final details of the operation, skimming a checklist on his datapad. At least this was a better assignment than knocking down ruined buildings, for the time being. He was glad to be flying again, even if it was only a sluggish transport carrier instead of a fighter. But he knew tougher assignments lay in the near future. Admiral Dalla and her three Imperial Star Destroyers had devastated the Kessel system, then vanished into hyperspace. The New Republic had sent its best trackers to find where she had gone to hide. Han insisted she was bound to make destructive guerrilla strikes, popping out of hyperspace and blasting a random planet. A loose cannon like Dalla would not follow a predictable overall strategy. The entire New Republic had to be on its guard. Chewbacca insisted that a New Republic occupation force head out to the Maw installation to free the other Wookiee slaves. The Alliance High Command also wanted to get their hands on any other plans and prototypes remaining in the secret weapons lab. So much for relaxing and picking up pieces, Wedge thought. Things are going to get a lot more interesting. But right now his assignment was to get the people of Eol Shah to safety on their new homeworld. When everything checked out on board, Wedge noticed Gantoris standing alone beside supply containers piled next to the wall. The displaced colony leader looked tall and powerful, but didn't seem to know how to react to seeing the relocation ship leave. "Don't worry," Wedge called, "we'll take your people to their new home. After living with volcanoes and earthquakes all their lives, Dantooine will seem like a paradise to them." Gantoris nodded, furrowing his smooth forehead. "Give them my greetings." Wedge waved to him. "You just go and become the best of the new Jedi Knights." Luke looked deep into the eyes of Kip Duran, searching for the core of a Jedi. The younger man flinched but continued to meet Luke's gaze. "Are you nervous, Kip?" Luke asked. "A little. Should I be?" Luke smiled as he remembered boasting to Yoda that he wasn't afraid of his impending Jedi training. "You will be," Yoda had said, "you will be." Han interrupted them, clapping his hand on Kip's shoulder. "You should have been there to watch him zipping through the dark spice tunnels. And he navigated us right through the Maw with his eyes closed. This kid has a lot of potential, Luke." Luke nodded. "I was about to do that trick in the Maw myself. I know how difficult it must have been." "Does that mean you'll take me for your Jedi Academy?" Kip asked. "I want to know how to use this power I have. While I was sitting in a cell on the Star Destroyer, I vowed never to be helpless again." Luke withdrew the power pack and sheet crystal sensor paddles from the old Imperial scanner that had once been used to detect Jedi descendants. "Let's try this scanner first." Untangling the cords, Luke stretched out the sheet crystal paddles on either side of Kip. "This won't hurt or anything. It just maps the potential of your senses." He tripped the scan switch on the control pack, and a narrow line of coppery light traveled down Kip's body as a smaller image of the copper scanline reappeared in reverse motion in front of them, digitizing its analysis of Kip Duran. Kip's reproduction hung in the air, bathed with the pale blue corona Luke had found on the others with genuine Jedi potential. But the aura waxed and waned, knotting itself, turning darker, growing brighter, streaked with red, then becoming tangled. "What does that mean?" Kip said. "He's okay, isn't he?" Han seemed eager to have his protege accepted. Luke wondered at the anomalous mapping, disturbed because he didn't know how to interpret it. The shimmer could be a result of faulty scanning equipment, since the instrument had been roughly treated and could no longer be calibrated, or it could be that because of the strain and pressure on Kip for so many years, he hadn't quite sprung back to his full potential yet. "I see a lot of power there." "A lot," Luke said, and Kip sighed at the reassurance. "Let me try one other test." Luke stretched out his hands to touch the curly black hair on Kip's head. "Let him do what he needs to," Han whispered to the young man. "Trust him."
Luke closed his eyes and sent a tendril of thought to the back of Kip's mind where the deep primal memories hid, leaving little room for conscious thought. Luke touched inward to the isolated nub in his subconscious. He pushed. And suddenly found himself hurled backward, tossed aside like a piece of fluff in a Bespin windstorm. He landed flat on his back on the other side of the room, gasping. Han and Kip ran toward him as he struggled to prop himself up on his elbows. Luke shook the daze from his head.
"I'm sorry," Kip said. "I don't know what I did. I didn't try to.
Honest.
What happened?"
Han said. "What does that mean for Kip?"
Luke blinked, then smiled at the others.
"Don't worry about me. I triggered that myself."
He shook his head.
"Kip, you have amazing power."
Luke stood up and gripped the young man's hand.
"You're definitely welcome to train at my academy. I just hope I know how to handle it when you come into full control of your abilities."
Epilogue. Luke Skywalker, Jedi Master, stood atop the great temple on the fourth moon of Yavin. Below his feet lay the empty throne room and grand audience chamber with skylights open to the sun. Garbed in a new Jedi cloak, wearing his lightsaber at his side, Luke felt warmth bathing him. Spicy, lingering scents rose as steam from the lush rainforest below. The ancient ruins left behind by the vanished Masasi race sprawled out in great geometrical edifices, now overgrown by voracious jungles. Luke stood on top of the ziggurat that had once been a towering lookout station when the rebel base had been housed on Yavin 4. In the sky, a swollen sphere of pale orange filled most of his view, the looming planet Yavin. The bloated gas giant had been a shield for the rebel base as the first Death Star orbited into position to fire with its planet-destroying superlaser. The Yavin base had been abandoned by the rebels years before. But many of the broken stone structures were still serviceable. With the unleashed might of the Maw fleet, and the expected depredations of Admiral Dalla, the New Republic desperately needed a strong force beyond pure military might, a group of guardians to maintain order in the galaxy. Luke intended to bring together everyone he could, immediately, not just Gantoris and Streen, but also Kip Duran, Mara Jade, several of the Witches of Dathomir, Cam Solosar, and others he had encountered since the Battle of Endor. And the search for new people with Jedi potential would have to be intensified. He needed candidates, as many as possible. The top levels of some of the flat-roofed Masasi structures had been clear enough for Luke to land his ship. On the broad courtyard once used as a launching pad by the Alliance, Luke's old X-Wing fighter lay cooling in the rising mists from the Yavin jungles. When Mon Mothma and Leia had offered Luke the abandoned rebel base, he had jumped at the chance. To begin his actual training, Luke tried to recreate all the exercises Yoda had taught him on Dagobah, as well as the practice sessions Obi-Wan Kenobi had begun. Luke also had the ancient Jedi holocron, the visual historical database Leia had taken from the resurrected Emperor's stronghold. He had studied the information from the hidden repository of Jedi knowledge on Dathomir. He had many tools, and his students carried inside themselves doorways to great power. But again Luke worried. If one of his trainees, or more than one, fell to the dark side, would he himself have the power to bring him back? And who was this dark man who haunted Gantoris's dreams with prophecies of destruction? As Luke looked across the sweeping vista of dense wilderness, he saw wide burned scars where fires had ravaged the rainforests. But the ecology of the moon struck back with a vengeance, healing itself. Dense clusters of sharp-smelling blue-leaf shrubs, Masasi trees, and climbing ferns clogged the ground in an impenetrable mesh that stretched as far as he could see, broken only by scattered temple ruins poking through the greensward. The alien constructions left behind by the Masasi seemed filled with secrets and knowledge of their own. Luke blinked his eyes and felt the power of the place around him, the wonder, the mystery of it all. He could not wait to begin bringing his students here. It was the perfect place to train a new order of Jedi Knights. End of story.
We hope you have enjoyed this audiobook presentation. Please visit our YouTube channel, YJK Audiobooks, for other exciting stories. Also, if you enjoy the audiobooks we create, please consider supporting the expense of our projects through our Patreon page. Those who do so have access to exclusive book series, are able to download the MP3 files for all books we create, and also have early access to our normal YouTube releases. For more details, please visit patreon.com/YJK Audiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. And now, please enjoy a preview of our Patreon exclusive book series, Galaxy of Fear. Star Wars. Galaxy of Fear. Book 1. Eaten Alive. Written by John Whitman. Preview. Zack and Tash Aranda are from the planet Alderaan. Or at least, they were, before the Empire destroyed their planet and killed their parents. Now, Zack and Tash travel the galaxy with their mysterious Uncle Hul, who has his own secret past he is trying to escape. Prologue. The security door slid open with a hiss. A dark figure stepped into the laboratory, where a single scientist stood over an examination table. On the table, something was still alive. As the dark figure approached, the scientist did not turn around. Only two other beings in the entire galaxy had access to his hidden fortress, and he knew who had come to see him. "Welcome, Lord Vader," the scientist said. The figure covered in black armor took a step closer. His face was hidden behind a black, skull-like breath mask. He was Darth Vader, Dark Lord of the Sith, the cruel right hand of the Emperor of the Galaxy. "Have you completed your research?" The scientist turned. In his hands he held a sharp, hooked instrument. Behind him, the creature on the table shuddered, then grew still. "Very nearly. The first 5 stages of my experiment are underway. Soon I will be able to complete the 6th and final stage. Then I shall provide the Emperor with the greatest power in the galaxy." "That claim has been made before," Vader said. "The Death Star was supposed to be the ultimate mechanical terror. It destroyed the planet Alderaan, but then the rebels destroyed the Death Star." "Pa," the scientist replied. "That battle station was a toy. My designs are not machines. I control the power of life itself. I will create the ultimate weapon for the Emperor." "The ultimate weapon," Vader cautioned, "is the Force." "Of course, of course." Vader stared at the scientist for a moment, his breath rasping through his mask like a threatening hiss. "You are running out of time. Already your work may have been discovered." The scientist scowled. "You mean by him? Don't worry about him. I will deal with him when the time comes." Vader raised one hand in caution. "If this secret should leak, as did the secrets of the Death Star, the Emperor and I will be most displeased." Then the Dark Lord turned away. The scientist stared after the armored figure, his eyes burning a hole into Vader's back. Soon, he thought, very soon, he would have the power to destroy even Darth Vader. Then he would take his place at the Emperor's side. He turned back to his experiments. He lowered his hooked blade. On the table, the creature screamed. Chapter 1. The attack came without warning. In a small quadrant of space, an X-wing starfighter altered its flight path slightly to avoid the massive red moon looming ahead. As it did, a twin ion engine ship, or TIE fighter, appeared in the moon's shadow, its 2 solar panels glinting with reflected light. Streaking through the void, the TIE opened fire, its 2 turbolasers spitting out streaks of flame. One of those laser shots creased the X-wing's hull. The X-wing's shields deflected most of the blast, and the shaken fighter banked away and accelerated to attack speed.
Relentlessly the TIE fighter followed. Not only was the TIE fast and maneuverable, but the pilot had an added advantage. She knew her opponent. She eyed him coldly as he twisted and turned in an effort to shake off his pursuer. But she stuck with him, sparing only quick glances at her tactical display, waiting for her target to fall into her sights. She grinned. "You are mine." The fleeing X-Wing made a sharp course adjustment and headed straight for the small red moon. That pilot knew who was behind him. It was the same enemy he had faced 100 times. She was good. If he was going to survive, he would have to be better. "Try this," he challenged. The X-Wing pilot aimed the nose of his ship at the moon. Instantly the moon's gravity grabbed hold of him, and his speed increased. At the last possible moment, the pilot veered away. Keeping just within gravity's reach, the X-Wing pilot gunned his engines and scraped along the moon's atmosphere. The belly of his ship left a trail of flames in the air as the tiny ship looped around the moon. The effect was like a slingshot. Pulled forward by gravity, the X-Wing hurtled around the moon's perimeter, far ahead of the pursuing TIE fighter. He came around the far side with his own lasers firing. But the TIE pilot was ready for him. "Oldest trick in the manual," she gloated. She had changed her course to intercept her quarry before he completed his backdoor maneuver, blasting the X-Wing with laser fire. The X-Wing jerked hard left in a desperate roll. Laser bolts exploded around his ship, but amazingly, not a single shot hit him. Laughing, the X-Wing pilot scooted past the TIE fighter, then curled around to continue the dogfight. "You are so lucky," the TIE pilot snapped. Suddenly a metallic hand as large as the red moon descended from the heavens to block the X-Wing's path. But the starfighter passed right through it. The owner of the hand looked down at the hollow table where the starfighter combat had taken place. He was DV-9, or DV for short, a silver droid designed to imitate the appearance and behavior of humans. Since his head and face were made of durasteel, the droid couldn't frown, but it gave the definite impression of doing just that. "Tash, Zach, stop this ridiculous game." The two pilots dropped their control discs, and the holographic starfighters, tiny in comparison to the droid looming over them, immediately froze in place. They hung in midair over the hollow table, along with the computer-generated moon and planet that served as a playing field. The hollow table was in a corner of a small lounge, which was in the forward compartment of a star cruiser called the Lightrunner, which was at that moment hurtling through hyperspace. The X-Wing pilot stood up from the hollow table. His name was Zach Aranda. He brushed back a lock of his messy brown hair and grinned at his opponent. The TIE fighter's pilot was his sister, Tash. At 13, she was a year older than her brother, and an inch taller. Her thick blonde hair was arranged in a neat braid, and her lightly freckled face was turned down in a serious frown. "You are so lucky," she repeated. "That was prime." Zach laughed. "And anyway, it's not luck, it's skill." Tash wasn't convinced. No one could have gotten away from that barrage. Besides, everyone knows all holo games are rigged so the Imperial ships have an advantage. The Empire would never let anyone else come out on top. "But you always win." She shook her head. "I just don't get it." "What you will get," said the impatient droid beside her, "is dull-witted from playing holo games. They're an utter waste of time. Besides, it's time for your zoology lesson." The droid put his hands on his swivel-socketed hips and waited. "Lessons?" Zach groaned. "We're in the middle of hyperspace." DV delivered the electronic version of a sniff. "There is no respite from learning." Or from bionic babysitters, Zach thought, aloud, he argued, but holo games are educational. They improve hand-eye coordination and encourage quick thinking, and... "And we're ready for lessons, DV," Tash interrupted. Not that she was very interested in zoology. She would much rather be reading one of her data files on Jedi lore, or downloading information from the holonet.
but sometimes it was good to set an example for a younger brother. Besides, she hated, really hated, being the Imperial TIE fighter, ever since the Empire had blown her and Zack's homeworld of Alderaan to bits. Zack and Tash had been away for 2 weeks and had returned home to find that, well, their home was gone. Their parents, friends, and neighbors were all killed in the explosion. DV punched a few commands into the holotable's control panel. Zoology lessons, the droid muttered to no one in particular. If he could have, he would have rolled his eyes. I have the brain capacity of a supercomputer and I'm giving zoology lessons. Zack and Tash hardly noticed. DV had been complaining about his new job since the day they had come to live with Uncle Hool. DV-9 was a Class 1 scientific research unit with an omni-task computer brain fast enough to calculate and record 10 million bits of information about alien cultures per second. He had been carefully designed to help his master, Hool the anthropologist, with important research into cultures across the galaxy. He was the envy of every droid he knew, until 6 months ago, when he was stuck with the job of caretaker to two young orphans. DV didn't like his new assignment, and he reminded Zack and Tash of it every chance he got. At the droid's command, the Star Battle program melted away and was replaced by a stream of holograms detailing various animals throughout the galaxy. The program settled on one odd image, an enormous, fanged beast, sitting without moving while three or four tiny birds fluttered in and out of its mouth. A recorded voice said, "One of the more unusual relationships in galactic nature is this one. The bloodthirsty rancor will kill everything it sees, except the gibbet bird, which roams freely inside the rancor's mouth. The rancor allows this because the gibbet birds pick the flesh from the rancor's jaws, and this helps keep the rancor's teeth clean." Unfortunately, as the zoology lesson continued, Tash found herself drifting off. She was a good student, but science was not her favorite subject. Tash slipped a data pad out of her pocket and held it in her lap, where neither Zack nor DV could see it. She keyed in a command, and the screen lit up with lines of text. It was a story about the Jedi Knights. It was also illegal. Legends of the Jedi Knights had been banned by the Empire since before Tash was born. But one day Tash had come across a story uploaded onto the galaxy-wide communications service known as the Holonet. Sitting at her desk in her room on Alderaan, Tash could sign onto the Holonet and scan libraries on distant planets or talk to people on worlds light-years away. One day she discovered a coded message filed under a word Tash had never seen before, Jedi. It had taken her hours to break the code, but finally the file had unscrambled before her eyes. The story Tash discovered was written by someone codenamed Forceflow, and it told the history of the Jedi Knights, a group of people who used something called the Force, to protect the galaxy from evil. According to the story, the Jedi Knights had been the guardians of the Old Republic for 1,000 generations. The only weapon a Jedi carried, Tash had learned, was a lightsaber, a handheld weapon made of pure energy. But the Jedi used violence only as a last resort. Instead, they relied upon a mysterious power known as the Force. Curious, Tash had sent a message to Forceflow, hoping to learn more. But Forceflow didn't respond, and his original story was erased from the net. After that, Tash kept her eye out for any information on the Jedi. She visited libraries, scanned the net, and talked to anyone who had a story about the Jedi or knew of the Force. She hoped to meet a Jedi someday. She hoped to be one someday. But soon after the first story was wiped from the net, all information about the Jedi vanished from the public records. It was replaced by a single report, stamped with the Imperial seal, stating that the Jedi had died out when the Old Republic gave way to the Empire. According to the official reports, the Jedi were extinct, DV droned. Imagine that. Tash looked up from her datapad. DV-9 was standing beside the image of a flock of blue-winged birds. The image was fading, and DV was obviously wrapping up his commentary. She had missed the entire lesson. "Well, that's enough for today," the droid said. "There will be an exam on this lesson next week.
Excused by their tutor, Zack and Tash escaped from the lounge. Tash looked at her brother and could see that she wasn't the only one who'd been daydreaming.
"What's on your mind?" she said.
"Home. Alderaan. Skimboarding in the park."
Zack paused.
"Mom and Dad. I miss them."
"Me too," Tash said softly. Just thinking about her parents made her want to cry. But she was the older sister and couldn't cry in front of Zack.
"Uncle Hul's our family now."
Zack sulked.
"Not really.
He's
not even human," Tash finished.
"Yeah, and he's
only related to us because his brother married Aunt Beryl."
"Right," said Zack.
"I don't even
know why he bothered to take us in."
"Stop that." Zack glared at his sister. She had an annoying habit of finishing other people's sentences.
"Sorry," his sister replied.
She hadn't noticed she was doing it again.
"But we've talked about Uncle Hul before.
He's not human, he's a Shido. They believe all their relatives are part of their close family.
So Hul felt that he had to take us in when?"
She could hardly say it.
"When Mom and Dad died. We should be happy we get to live with someone who cares about us.
He never shows it.
He always looks like he's going to a funeral."
"You're just too hard on him."
Tash argued harder than she believed.
"He can be very friendly."
"Oh, yeah."
Zack huffed.
"Then what's his first name?"
"Well, that's easy, his name is.
I mean, I'm sure I've heard him.
That is."
She stopped. Now that she thought about it, Uncle Hul never had told them his first name.
Maybe he doesn't have a first name, she decided.
Maybe he's just Hul.
Maybe, Zack said with a sudden gleam in his eyes, he just doesn't want us to know.
Maybe it's something secret.
Maybe there's a price on his head.
Zack Aranda, your imagination is galactic.
Maybe he's part of the rebellion and that's why he moves around so much.
Tash was growing impatient.
Bring it in for a landing, Zack.
He's an anthropologist.
He goes to different planets to study the species that live there.
Sure, that's what he tells us.
But if that's all there is, why does he keep his name a secret?
I'm going to find out.
How are you going to do that?
Easy.
I'll check his cabin.
Zack turned to go.
You can't do that.
It's rude.
Besides, what if he finds you?
He won't find me, Zack said.
He's in the ship's library, doing research.
He's always in the ship's library, doing research.
Zack turned to go.
Want to help?
No, Tash said firmly.
It's not something a Jedi Knight would do.
You're not a Jedi Knight.
I'm still not going.
Come on.
It's not as though I'm going to dig through his personal files.
I'm just going to glance at his desk to see if his name is on anything.
His sister shook her head.
I'm going back to the cockpit to practice my piloting.
Suit yourself.
Zack turned and hurried down the hall.
Tash frowned after him.
At least she had gotten him to think about something besides their parents.
Now if someone could just do the same for her.
While Tash headed toward the cockpit, Zack crept toward the ship's living quarters.
The last cabin belonged to Uncle Hul.
Zack pressed the collar.
No answer.
Zack pressed the opener and the door slid back with a soft whoosh.
And Zack found himself staring into the face of a fanged and drooling monster.
Its bulk filled the doorway, and it was so close that Zack could smell its hot, stinking breath.
He cried out and stumbled backward, tripping over his own feet and falling to the ground.
The creature lunged forward and bent over him.
One clawed hand reached for his throat.
Chapter 2.
The creature grabbed Zack's shirt and pulled him to his feet.
"What are you doing here?" it demanded in a voice like sliding gravel.
I, Zack stammered.
He could feel the creature's putrid breath on his face. The creature paused. It let go of Zack's shirt and took a step back. Then, before Zack's eyes, its flesh began to quiver and crawl. The monster's entire body squirmed and changed shape. After only a few seconds, it had transformed into something close to human. But its dark gray skin and extra-long fingers revealed it to be quite different. "Uncle Hool," Zack gasped. "It's you." "You are in my cabin," Hool said sternly. "Who else would you find here?" Zack's knees were still shaking, but he felt relieved. He should have known this would happen eventually. Uncle Hool was a Shido. Although they looked mostly human, Shido were aliens with a very non-human ability, they could change shape. "Sorry," he said with one final shudder. "I just didn't. I mean, I've never seen you do that before. What was that thing you turned yourself into?" Hool turned his back on Zack and began to examine a small datapad. "A creature I observed in my travels. It keeps my shape-changing skills in practice," he replied. "Practice for what?" Hool's gaze was like a blaster bolt. "For eating annoying small boys." Tash believed it was her job as the older sister to make things easier for Zack, but she missed her parents terribly. She remembered the day she heard they were dead. She felt so lost and alone that she thought she'd go crazy. The truth was, although she missed Alderaan, the only people she really missed were her parents. Tash had always had trouble making friends. Other kids thought she was weird because she was always finishing their sentences, or making predictions about what day a pop quiz was going to be held, or getting strange feelings about things. Usually they were sad or frightening things. Like the day her parents died. She knew it had happened even though she was light years away. She felt like something was suddenly torn out of her. That had been the worst time, but not the first time. When she had heard the news, Tash had wanted to lock herself in her room forever. But Zack wouldn't let her. He was just as sad and scared as she was, but he showed it in a different way. He stopped being afraid of anything. He became a daredevil, risking his neck on silly stunts like skimboarding, his current dangerous hobby. Tash knew he needed someone to watch over him. And she found to her surprise that she actually liked the little womp rat. So instead of closing herself off from the galaxy, Tash had decided to face it with him. And she had made a promise to herself that she would never lose anyone close to her ever again. Tash entered the Lightrunner's cockpit, with all its delicate instruments and gauges. The pilot and co-pilot seats were empty, because the Lightrunner was operating on automatic. Tash slid into the pilot seat. She double-checked to make sure the navigational systems were securely locked on automatic, then grabbed the two levers that controlled the main thrusters. In her mind she saw an image far sharper than any holographic projection. The Imperial battle station was surrounded by a gauntlet of TIE fighters, itching to test themselves against a young Jedi Knight. Lost in her imagination, Tash was eager to meet their challenge. Zack hadn't given up on Uncle Hool. In fact, staring at Uncle Hool's back while the anthropologist pored over his work, Zack became angry. It wasn't fair. Hool had volunteered to take them, but he refused to tell them anything about himself. He didn't even tell them where they were going. That bothered Zack, and he knew it bothered his sister, too. For the last 6 months, Hool had dragged them all across the galaxy on his research, but he never explained what he was doing. "Where are we headed?" Zack finally demanded. Hool looked up from his work. He scowled at Zack. "Are you still here?" "Oh, very well. The planet is called Devourin. Does it mean anything to you?"
"No."
"Then go away. What are you going to do there?" Zack asked. Hool was exasperated. He handed Zack his computerized datapad. "Read this file." "But only this file." The file Zack read told him the planet's story. Devourin was a typical life-bearing planet, tree-covered continents, salty blue oceans, and fresh, breathable air. According to rumor,
it was the richest and most beautiful planet within a thousand light years. It was inhabited by creatures who called themselves Enzine. They were intelligent and very friendly. Considering the hundreds of magnificent unstudied planets in the galaxy, Devarin didn't seem worth an anthropologist's time. Except for one thing. No one had ever noticed it before. Devarin was less than a light year from one of the galaxy's busiest space lanes, and yet it had never appeared on anyone's star charts. One day the planet wasn't there, and the next day it was. That's impossible, of course, Hul said as Zack finished reading. Planets do not just appear out of nowhere. It's a mistake in the star charts. Oh. Without thinking, Zack pressed next on the datapad, and a new file popped onto the screen. He saw the words, Imperial Orders, and Payment Received, just as Hul snatched the pad from his hand. I told you to read nothing else. Sorry, I was just. You were just snooping, Hul interrupted. Don't ever snoop in my cabin again. The Shido turned back toward Zack, towering frighteningly over him. If you do, you will be very, very sorry. Hul took another step forward and Zack gulped. Whatever Hul planned to do next, he never got the chance. Both he and Zack were thrown to the floor by a sudden jolt. The Lightrunner shuddered and groaned as though some giant force had grabbed hold of it. Over the scream of the engines, Zack heard his uncle cry, "We're out of control." End of chapter. This book is part of our exclusive series available to Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and may the Force be with you, always.